reporters on the ground who will be joining us from inside and outside the convention center. A lot of big developments, obviously. We've got excerpts of some of the speeches last night. We have Bernie Sanders being booed when he first came out and said, I'm with her. And then you've got also Michelle Obama saying the same thing. Oh, you're with her. She's a she. So it's okay, like the DNC memos said last year. We're doing whatever it takes. We don't care what voters say. We're going to put a woman in. So it's okay to get rid of voting as long as you have the gimmick. It's okay to block the voters as long as you have the stunt that it's a woman. Man, talk about emptiness. Talk about shallowness. We've got the Washington Post and others trying to spin this that it's okay to have the superdelegates basically ignoring what all the other delegates are saying who represent the voters, who were pledged to the voters. You know what is clear here? If they're willing to steal an election, if they're willing to steal a primary, they're willing to steal the big general election. And the big news that I've been reporting since Sunday with Roger Stone is the Trump camp is fully aware of that problem and is preparing major contingencies for it. So this is going to be a spectacular collision. As some polls have Donald Trump 10 points ahead, many 7 points, most scientific polls 5 points ahead. A minority of polls 4 points or 3 points, but all of it within the margin of error. That's a big deal. And there's obviously the whole closeted effect that most people are scared to say they're voting for Trump, especially if they're liberal trendies, because they're afraid of being called racist. And so they're very, very closeted in their activities. But my dead reckoning tells me Trump's probably, I think Trump's about 15 points ahead. And if we're able to reach the Bernie Sanders people, that are the majority of Democratic voters, and get them out of their mind control and get them to actually vote for Trump, not just for one of the third party candidates because they hate Hillary rightfully so much, I think Trump could win by 25%, way bigger than Reagan's landslide of what they call 10% or so. And that's because there's a major political realignment. We can hardly find, whether it's Texas or California, New York or Pennsylvania, Florida, Oregon, we can hardly find anyone that supports Hillary. I was driving around Austin yesterday and saw Bernie Sanders stickers on every 5th or 6th car. And so I was driving up to a dental appointment, and then I drove all the way back to South Austin, then to West Austin. I was driving around for about 2 hours yesterday taking care of errands. Actually longer because thunderstorms hit and there was horrible traffic snarl going home. I was in traffic an hour. So I guess I was on the road 2.5 hours yesterday taking care of errands. It was one of those days. So I've been out of town. And there were just Bernie Sanders stickers everywhere. There were Donald Trump stickers everywhere. There were InfoWars stickers here and there. But there were just no Hillary stickers. I saw one Hillary sticker, one. Because when you're stuck in traffic and driving around in a giant city from, you know, basically the four corners of it, you start playing little games and stuff while you listen to the radio or, you know, take phone calls and do business. And I was just on the lookout. Amazing. But that's what our reporters have found. Where are the Hillary supporters? And everybody's talking about this phenomenon. We can find almost no one on the streets that supports her. Most people say they're going to vote third party or for Trump. And these are hardcore liberals. So good job to them. I mean, I was really ashamed of the fact they weren't able to stop theft by Hillary. But, I mean, what are they going to do? The mainstream media is allied with it. But what happens when the general public, local government, and others realize that the mainstream media is allied with foreign interests that have hijacked the nation and are basically suspending our elections? What happens at that point? That's the big question. We have more Islamic beheadings and attacks. We're going to get to all of it straight ahead. This is the 26th day of July 2016. I'm your host, Alex Jones. We're going to be here for the next 4 hours live. Then kicking off at 11 a.m. tomorrow, all the way through till 3 p.m. the next day. That is 28 hours of live broadcast. We'll have some special reports and boil-down interviews and live reports from the ground in Philadelphia as Hillary is coronated queen, the first time in U.S. history that a presidential nominee publicly ignores a massive landslide by the other candidate, and where the superdelegates newly created in the 1970s but never used openly steal the popular vote and appoint her the nominee. And if you think they're going to do that nakedly out in the middle of plain view and not steal the general election, I got a bridge I want to sell you. But here's the good news. I don't need to get this information from Roger Stone or other folks close to Donald Trump. I can tell you point blank, directly from Donald Trump, he is fully aware of what they're planning to do. And they are fully aware of the fact that he is surging way more than 4 or 5 points in national so-called scientific polls conducted by CNN and others. Those polls are completely spun, targeting Democrat voters, elderly people that have landlines and things like that. When you go out and do real focus groups, especially in battleground states, in some areas, he's gone from 3 to 5 points ahead to 10 points ahead. Now, if you were Hillary Clinton, who's already gone for broke and who's willing to do basically anything, what would you be pulling? We have over an hour of Nigel Farage interview that has not even aired yet because we got 3 different interviews with him. We've got some excerpts of that that are going to air today that are very powerful. Obviously, the founder and leader of UKIP, recently stepped down, but still the leader in spirit. We have a large part of that interview, about 40 minutes, that'll be airing never before seen tomorrow during the 28-hour transmission. And a lot of other interviews have never before been seen as well. Not just my co-hosts and anchors and reporters, not just our crew on the ground, not just a whole list of amazing guests. It's going to be a very, very important broadcast tomorrow where we really dig into every angle of what's happening in our society and track the latest things that are unfolding, not just here in the United States, but geopolitically. So definitely stay with us for that. Here are some of the headlines up on Infowars.com. This one by Steve Watson. Dems panic over Trump surge. Michelle Obama calls Trump hateful in DNC speech while she talks about Obama wakes up in a house built by slaves. That'd be like if you were in the Roman Colosseum and you were Italian or have a Latin background and you started crying going, I had ancestors that might have been killed in here. I'm walking around. I mean, this is the craziest, just invoking of division anyone could ever imagine. It's so incredibly clear that that's the game here. And you have the new VP candidate of Hillary, Tim Kaine, promises bill to legalize illegal immigrants in first 100 days. And of course, that means legalize people with criminal records. That means legalize people that came here illegally. All the people trying to come here legally, well, they're just thrown to the wayside. But obviously, let's get into the big story that's front and center. If you go to drudgereport.com, you can see an image of the priest that had his head chopped off this morning during morning mass. ISIS has celebrated the men who killed the priest and attacked and stabbed others, have given credit to ISIS, and I'm quite frankly surprised that even UK newspapers and French newspapers admitted it was Islamic terror, because with the machete attack, the hatchet attack, the shooting attack, and the bombing attack that ran from Friday through Sunday, I mean, we're talking about attacks every day now. In fact, there's so many attacks, there's several here I've got in the stack, I can't even keep track of them anymore, because this is a worldwide ISIS offensive. I started telling people about 3 years ago when ISIS first came out with this new name. I said they fly the Al-Qaeda flag. It's Al-Qaeda renamed in Syria because our military is refusing to back them. They want to confuse the public and try to have us now back ISIS. When that failed, Turkey made a deal with NATO to bring them through and bring them into Europe to start a new crisis there. When you see 80% military-age men walking through Europe, getting on trains, and Merkel inviting them in, you know it's an organized plan. And I said, when they attack, when there's terror attacks, they will say it's not terror attacks, and they will say that anyone criticizing it will be arrested. That's now started happening. and that you have to have Islamic classes in all public and private schools so that you, quote, won't anger them. Germany started doing that 2 years ago. The United States is starting it next year under federal Common Core standards. Many schools have already begun it. You can just type in public schools teaching Islam to teach tolerance in wake of attacks. That's how they spin it. We cut your head off. We shoot you. We blow you up. We go in your nightclub and murder you. You have to turn your guns in. You have to turn your free speech in. And we have seen, remember yesterday, BBC scrubs Ali from Munich Killer's name on TV in articles and on social media. And in some articles, they changed his name to David. In fact, here it is. His name's not been officially released, but he's being named locally. That's a weird way to spin it, as David Sanballi. Oh, man. I mean, whoa. Next level, man. Next level. ISIS always takes responsibility. They always take responsibility. The killers do. But it's never reported until about a week later in the back of the paper. In fact, I had liberal media in Cleveland many times look at me and say, you're a liar. The mass shooting or the truck that ran over all the people in Nice, he didn't have accomplices. He wasn't Islamic. And it's like in the news he had five accomplices. In the news he was being coordinated. It's admitted that it was Al-Qaeda training on how to use a vehicle. It's incredible. By the way, there's also this big white supremacist movement, a lot of it funded by Saudi Arabia and others, we've learned, that is saying all these jihad attacks are being carried out by Israelis. Now, let me give you the facts, okay? If someone falls on a banana peel, a Jew didn't do it. Radical Islam does exist. It was a false flag to have NORAD stand down to allow the supposed hijackers back and forth when they were on a terrorist list. And that event of 9/11 was used to attack non-radical secular Muslim countries like Iraq and blame them for what the Wahhabists, bare minimum, were involved in on 9/11. So there are events where they're staged or where the door is opened up, and we expose those. But these aren't false flags to blame Muslims, because the controlled global media won't even say it's Muslims and covers it up with Beyond 1984 Newspeak and Ministry of Truth bizarreness. They're screaming Allah Akbar and pledging allegiance to ISIS, and they cover it up. He did that on the 911 tapes from the gay bar. And these other events, the McDonald's attacker, the guys that chopped the priest's head off and started stabbing people today in Normandy. I'm going to try to explain this to you. The false flag is that our governments are letting these people in and covering up what they're doing as a pretext to then take our liberties and set up a police state. That's the false flag. This is real terror. ISIS is hundreds and hundreds of thousands of fighters and allowed to recruit all over the West. I saw them being protected years ago under the name Al-Qaeda, 5 years ago when they started the Syrian civil war. The globalists are running Islam. They're allowing the most radical forms of it to take over the entire religion and mass murder other Muslims. These attacks are real. And our governments bringing them in is real. And when they launch, these are probing attacks. I kept telling you, they're going to get larger and they're going to get closer together. We're being probed, we're being conditioned, we're being acclimated, we're being tested. This is a military technique where you do probing attacks that slowly increase until the enemy you're attacking gets used to being attacked, so the enemy doesn't get really upset and mount an offensive. If there's a big attack, like a 9/11 or a Pearl Harbor, they know you'll stand up and take action in a big way. But if you slowly escalate the attacks, you tend to actually evolve, in their words, or adapt to being killed. And that's why the French Prime Minister said 2 weeks ago, we must accept terror and live with it. And it's right-wingers criticizing Islam's fault. They're telling you, get used to it. And the Islamists have made deals with the leaders of France and Germany that they will be demis, they will be taken care of, they will be financed by Saudi Arabia and others if they accept the killing. Now, a lot's happening in the DNC. We're going to be looking at all of that coming up. We've got the latest on exactly what happened in the Religion of Peace attack in Normandy. The latest on Hillary trying to steal the election. Here's a headline. Suicide bomber had recorded video on his phone pledging allegiance to ISIS before blowing himself up, injuring 12. But by the time it hit the BBC and the Telegraph and others, it said that a Syrian refugee was killed in a bomb blast. That's right. BBC reports German suicide bombing as if suicide bomber was the victim. Syrian migrant dies in German blast. That's the headline. Think about that. That's how they operate. That's how stupid they think you are. And imagine this collaborator media, if they stage false flags and blame it on patriots and start arresting people and disappearing us, the mainstream media will go along with it with pleasure. They told you Obamacare would make your health care free or cheaper. They told you you could keep your doctor. Then they said they never said that. And then Gruber said that he was hired by Obama to lie to the stupid public. And thank God you're so stupid, he said. And thank God the Hillary delegate said, we're going to ban the guns, but we're keeping it secret. I've been talking to Hillary. The plan is, oh, we're going to deceive them. And of course, they stole the Bernie votes. But it's okay, because they're liberal when they overthrow Libya and put al-Qaeda in charge or try to overthrow Syria and start a civil war. Because they have pseudo-intellectual followers with the IQ of Muppets. When I say that, I'm serious. There's either evil Hillary minions that are preying on people who aren't even that smart, or they're like Muppet creatures. And then you talk to the Bernie people, they're pretty darn smart. Very articulate. I'm not kissing their butt. I've really attacked Bernie supporters because at the end of the day, socialism is one of the easiest things just to corrupt and take over. So is capitalism. But capitalism, hands down, produces more wealth and more choices and more opportunity in history than anything else times 100. Even our broken form of crony capitalism is better than socialism. But we're going into a pure monopoly. Don't worry. And you'll get the crumbs, like Diamond and Silk say. They'll call that socialism. So you got fascism up here at the top, crony capitalism, and then they knock some crumbs off the side to us down here on the floor, like little mice, and you go, here's your socialism. And then they control your whole destiny, your whole life. And now they've gotten to the point of where there's terror attacks every day in France, every day in Germany. I mean, they're covering a lot of these up. And they're arresting Germans that mildly criticize it. But now Hollande can't ignore it anymore. See, they've reached that moment, because he was saying this wasn't Islamic terror just a few weeks ago. Hollande says France, that's their president, is at war with ISIS, Islamist knife men chanting Allah Akbar, behead French priest, 86, and leave none fighting for her life. They were going to kill a bunch of people inside, but the cops showed up very quickly, fighting for her life, storming the mass before police shoot them dead. Well, the headline should be knife beheads priest, because it said truck, you know, kills 80-something in Nice. Catholic church where priest was murdered was among several targets found on the suspected jihadist arrest listed last year. Yep. It's all about fear. In Muslim nations, the last churches are closing all over the world because they'll come and kill you because it's a religion of peace. People say, but be nice to the Muslims. You know, there's nice ones. Yeah, but the dominant part of the religion is go murder. They're all killing each other. You got Sunnis killing Sunnis because this other group isn't radical enough. It's a joke. It needs to be reformed. Admit it. Germany boosts police presence and warns of further terrorism. Well, I thought there was no such thing as terrorism. Alert raised after the latest bombing, Ansbach. The fourth bloody act of violence in the country in a space of a week. Yeah, there's more than that. Meanwhile, the Pope says open the borders more, and that it's our fault. And he says he didn't want to hear about the Christian roots. That makes him become physically ill. Of course, he lives behind giant walls himself, and if you get caught trying to climb them, you get shot by the Swiss Guard. But don't worry, the London mayor, an admitted jihadi, seeks more powers to protect post-Brexit city. He wants powers, Reuters reports, to ignore the federal government and make it an EU city. That's called munialization. Schwarzenegger heads up the global program for that. Austin, Texas, to a great extent, is under UN control. We have a pretty good police department and some good people in the city. But the top of the city is literally going under UN rules. They've got all these armed code enforcers running around harassing everybody. That is a police state and disgusting. See the average cop around Austin, they're nice. You see a code enforcer, I saw some yesterday, they were just bugging their eyes out at people walking into a 7-Eleven. I mean, if I didn't have to get somewhere, I was going to go in and confront them and say, why are you walking around like you're a third world, you know, North Korean police officer? For 23 hours, 27 minutes out from the kickoff of the 28-hour live broadcast tomorrow. Infowars.com/giant to find the free audio and video feeds. Stations are welcome to carry parts of it or all of it. Stations are welcome free to air to put their commercials over any segments they want, because large parts of it are going to be commercial free. We're going to be putting the links up at Infowars.com/giant. to the TV satellite feed, the radio satellite feeds, and also the HD video stream feed and a lower res feed as well. And it really, it's live coverage of the DNC, coronation of Hillary to a great extent, but also what's happening geopolitically. And it is a super sale fundraiser. I don't really call this a money bomb, because all we're doing is giving you some of the best specials of the year. And when I say best specials of the year, I've never offered 40% off on BrainForce, one of our best-selling products. It is a brain nootropic. It has amazing properties that are well-documented. One of the ingredients is prescription in Europe. This, in a healthy way, boosts your mental faculties. It certainly has for myself. I'll warn you, though, if you're already super tired and you take this, because I was doing this some in Cleveland, it'll give you energy that coffee and stuff won't. But I've noticed Dew and I both get a little mean when we're on it, if we're already super exhausted. So you need to understand that it's some serious stuff, real serious stuff. So check it out. 40% off, a great way to support the broadcast. But more importantly, a great way to try out BrainForce and see how great this nootropic is for yourself. Incredibly low price. We're also setting it up at InfoWarsStore.com, where you can pay full price if you want to just support the broadcast. We have the discount. You can click it and get it 40% off, or you can pay full price. You can also sign up for auto ship, get 10% off on top of that. Or you can also order $50 or more, free shipping. So there's a lot of specials. 20% off Survival Shield X2, the good halogen. 20% off Super Male Vitality. Those are huge specials, and a lot more at InfoWarsLife.com for the nutraceuticals, or InfoWarsStore.com, the umbrella site. We have the third edition Hillary for Prison t-shirts that are about to sell out. When those do, the fourth generation will be here. And we have the new Hillary rape shirt. Oh, excuse me, Bill rape shirt. She just covers up for him. It shows Bill Clinton, and then under it says the words rape, like the iconic Obama hope chain shirt. You want to trigger a minion of Hillary? This is what you wear. Though I'll be quite honest with you. And by the way, this shirt's already been the London Guardian, the New York Times. It's already gotten a lot of attention. And we are the exclusive distributor of it right now. Roger Stone developed a shirt with his crew. I will assure you that you will see triggering, but the problem is there aren't really any Hillary supporters out there. And we also have the new Texas-style Molon Labe with the M4 in gray and camouflage, and we have it with the good old Texas Cannon variety as well. This fabric is so soft. These are made in America shirts, printed in America shirts, only $22.95, and the shirts almost cost us $10. So this is a designer style shirt. In fact, I love this type of fabric. It's cotton with a mix. So I actually went and found out who the manufacturer was of this style shirt. Found out it was made in America, and it was a lot less than some of the companies I'd used before. And so it is the type of shirt you pay $35, $40 for. We're selling it for $22. It is a designer shirt. Again, I have bought this shirt with a different design, but the same shirt, for $35 at a shopping center. Okay? $22. But what matters is it funds the operation, you know, the 10 bucks we make or so. Don't tread on me on the back, Infowars.com. You don't have to be a Texan. It's just like wearing a Molon Labe. You don't have to be Greek from Thermopylae in the Battle of 300 to wear a Molon Labe shirt to celebrate. That means come and take it. So Texans were saying Molon Labe. In fact, they had some flags, even had it in Latin and in Greek. And so they were taking that. They weren't stealing it. They were taking it at Gonzales, at the Alamo, from the 300. You had 180-something at the Alamo. Same deal. There's famous battles with the Japanese where a couple hundred, you know, held off a couple thousand. This is something in every culture. So whether you're Japanese or whether you're African, you know, from Nigeria, or whether you're from Mexico, it doesn't matter. You can be part of this. This is just a modern example of come and take it. Everybody gets killed. But it doesn't matter. That then helps the sleeping giant awaken. It's the sacrifice, ladies and gentlemen. It's the will to commit. It's the archetype that we see in culture. But it's not just in movies and in fantasy land where, you know, the old general gets cut down before he launches the whole next generation of resistance. The tree of liberty must be watered with the blood of patriots and tyrants, to quote Thomas Jefferson. So Operation Sleeping Giant, super sale, fundraiser, now live at InfoWarsStore.com. InfoWarsLive.com, or if you have any questions, you can call and order over the phone. 888-253-3139. Take advantage today. Now, by the way, we've had election coverage before just with the free audio and video streams that has had 3.2 million people tune in on top of our regular radio and TV audience of millions. But a lot of times we do live election coverage and only 400,000, 500,000. Oh, that's terrible. Bigger than the average MSNBC show tunes in. But when you get the links to, say, Infowars.com/giant or Infowars.com/show, which will both have the live feed kicking off tomorrow at 11 a.m., when you spread the word about that, or when you're listening on a local station and call your friends and family and tell them, tune in, something special is happening right now on the radio. America's waking up. The sleeping giant is rising. It's your energy. It's your excitement that is infectious. It's the cure to this disease. The globalists see us as a disease. No, they're the disease. So we're reaching this epic tidal shift moment right now. And so take that link. We're going to put it on Facebook, Twitter. Send those links out to everyone you know. Not just for this special live event, for other special live events. Because we're seeing the Liberty Movement with the figurehead who has the courage and the honor to stand against the threats, the intimidation, the lies. We're seeing the incredible action take place right now with Donald Trump up there to where political correctness is being crushed. We are seeing a movement now where they tried to steal the election from Trump, but were unable to. They're now partly successful doing it with Bernie when he won by even bigger margins from the numbers I've seen than Trump did against other Republicans. I mean, it's staggering how bad he trounced her. Oh, you won by 20 points in New Hampshire? We're taking it. Oh, you won by 20-something points in California? We're taking it. Oh, we already met yesterday with superdelegates who decided your vote doesn't count. And then it's hardly even in the newspapers, and the Washington Post is out there defending it today. There's no way long-term they're getting away with this. Unless they bring in a total dictatorship, shut down the free speech, and really start arresting people en masse. That's what's happening in China. That's what's happening in Turkey. That's what's happening in Venezuela. That's what's happening in areas of Europe. Folks, this is really happening. And if you think we're immune from this, we have all the hallmarks of a very dangerous third world country now with nuclear weapons and a very crazed, corrupt, decadent elite engaged in class and race warfare to keep the peasants all fighting with each other while they rob the entire show and try to steal the future. Now, that said, I've got a bunch of clips I want to go to, a lot of things I want to break down. The first thing I want to play is Nigel Farage talking to our reporter, Margaret Howell, And again, a lot of these interviews that we taped last week with him, we had four different interviews with him, have never aired. Those are going to be cobbled together and aired tomorrow during the 28-hour special broadcast with a lot of other stuff. Just get ready. A lot of surprises, you name it. But before we go any further, I want to play what Faraj had to say about I'm not leaving the movement. And he told me some things at dinner a couple nights after we did the interview. And he said, listen, I've been the leader of the party since we founded it 24 years ago. I just can't keep leading it forever. I got to let new blood in. Obviously, there's been security threats. People have come after him. He doesn't get into that. He wants to spend some time with his family. He's still in the EU Parliament for a couple more years, but he said, I'm not going to be the leader of the party anymore. I'm giving folks in the UK government, like the Conservatives, a chance to do the right thing and follow the voters' edict. And if they don't, I'll be forced to come back. But boy, they're putting the screws to us, trying to shut our economy down right now, and I'm going to be battling to make sure that the EU doesn't try to persecute us. So he's an amazing leader. He's very charismatic. He's very, very plain spoken, but it's powerful. And so I'm glad to hear he's not leaving the movement, even though they set up his plane, they attacked his car repeatedly. The police in France and elsewhere have said, no, they're trying to kill him. And Faraj does have folks coming after him. It's very serious. Very serious. So can you imagine? I mean, the globalists aren't playing games. And they have really, really tried to take this guy out. So he is a hero. Here's part of that interview.
Margaret Howell reporting for InfoWars.com here in Cleveland, where we just saw Nigel Farage speak to Tucker Carlson. He was addressing the questions of where is he going? Why is he leaving? What's he going to do next? He said he's going to stay in an advisory position and be very much a part of leading Britain out of the EU. He answered our questions. He wouldn't comment, though, on whether or not he felt safe. He said he doesn't discuss the personal side of this. But victorious leader came to Cleveland. He wouldn't comment on the RNC other than to say that he doesn't like Hillary Clinton. And we asked him some pretty interesting questions. You're going to catch our interview in just a second. I'm Margaret Howell reporting for InfoWars.com. Ask you why you're going to quit, because we're just wondering, like, what's going to happen to the movement if you go?
Well, I'm not going completely. I'm not disappearing. I'm not moving up into the mountains to live in a shed, you know? I mean, I'm going to go on being an MEP until we exit the European Union and overseeing that process and commenting on it. And I will, if I can, hold the government's feet to the fire to make sure that they hold faith with the people that have voted. And I'm still going to be around and commenting and saying things and doing things and supporting the party. You can't be leader forever. Nobody can be leader. No matter who you are, you can't do it forever. I've been doing this a hell of a long time. I've dedicated 25 years of my life to getting back the democratic independence of our country. We've won this referendum. I think now was the right time.
You're not retiring fully. You're just...
I am not retiring. You know, I haven't... I'm not going to go and sit and, as I say, up in the hills and smoke a pipe all day. No.
Are you worried that the globalists are going to try to hijack this Brexit?
They can try if they want to, but it won't work. Those people who made their minds up to vote for Brexit, despite all the threats that they were getting from the international community, the political, I mean, couldn't it be, the US president even came to London to tell them what they should do. And they made their minds up, they struck out, they voted for freedom. That's what they voted for. If they don't get it, they don't get it, if they're betrayed, then you'll see even bigger political shocks than we saw with the Brexit result.
Are you worried about your personal safety at all?
Well, whether I am or not, I don't discuss that sort of thing in public. It doesn't make sense.
All right, now, again, we're going to have like, I think it's 45 minutes, at least the clip I saw, several interviews. Leanne did an interview, Hal did, others did. So our crew interviewed him three different times, so it's big. We got a Tucker Carlson interview in there as well. That's all coming up tomorrow. I tell you, get to know Tucker Carlson in person. He's been under to visit me a couple times. And I got to have dinner with him for about 2 hours. And he's a patriot. He's just kind of been waiting for America to wake up so that he could successfully, I guess, keep his job at Fox News, telling the truth. But you can also see the writing on the wall that they're not going to let people tell the truth at Fox News. Just since they forced Ailes out last Wednesday, I've already been watching Fox every day. Massive difference in coverage. I'm watching it, and it's like I'm watching CNN, unless it's Hannity. And I think they're going to fire Hannity. I mean, they want to destroy it. They want to destroy it. They want to shut this country down. Rupert Murdoch's a Hillary supporter, and his sons are even worse. A lot of folks go, good, everybody will just come to your show. I don't want to be successful on the backs of people who were censored and shut down, but it's more important than that. I'm not a moron. If they can hijack and infiltrate and take down Fox News, as David Brock swore he would do in a Politico article 4 years ago with, quote, infiltrators, he said, we got Soros money. It was in Politico. We have already infiltrated alternative media. We're targeting it, and we're going to sabotage it and bring it down, and Fox News is front and center. And we have specifically, folks, I can tell you, dealt with Media Matters operatives. And he said, we are infiltrating. Infiltration. Military operations. They mean business. And now that they're finishing up at Fox, they're going to try to absorb that. That's a big elephant to eat. They're going to move on to Drudge next, Rush Limbaugh, and then yours truly. And they're like, well, Alex, you don't agree with Rush Limbaugh on quite a few things. It doesn't matter. He's pro-gun. He doesn't want to destroy the country. He doesn't want to deindustrialize us. Rush is not a globalist. They're going to get him. People go, well, wow, you've been up against him for 19 years. Aren't you glad? No, I'm not glad. I never wanted to be up against Rush Limbaugh. The network I'm on doesn't tell me what to say, but they told me what time slot I was on if I wanted to be carried on that network. Now, I'm separate from the network now for many years, own my own show, control it, have my own separate media operations, but this is the slot I'm in. I was a nighttime host, and but I know I take no pleasure. I mean, I don't know if people's brains work that if Drudge went away, I would get way less traffic. See, people don't get it. A movement needs to grow and take back the country and the world. I'm not a movement of myself that wants to be the one big guy as the ship goes under. And I'm sitting on top of the crow's nest, you know, as the last person to go under the ice. No, thank you. I mean, it's just the way people think. No wonder some people aren't successful. I can't tell you the so-called liberty movement, how many other talk show hosts and people have come and gone who had talent because all they wanted to do was hijack the movement, control it, and make stuff up about people like it was some kind of junior high prom where everyone's putting out rumors about the quarterback. Because they're jealous of him. I mean, it's mental illness. I'm in a war to try to defeat tyranny for my family because I believe in a level playing field and know how dangerous tyranny is historically. And so everybody better understand what's happening at Fox News is bad news. I've had so many people celebrate it to me. Oh, I hate them. They're fake conservatives. Look at them. Oh, my gosh. Oh, of course, they're going to make it liberal now. Ha, ha, ha. And I'm like, do you understand what this means? I guess you don't. And it's not even bad people that are talking to me like this. I mean, they're overall smart folks, but yes, Fox has been controlled for a certain extent because Ailes was being threatened the whole time. They want to control the conservative movement, and they want to model it after kind of the Rockefeller Republicans and kind of slowly put it to sleep and slow it down. And so folks think that there's really an opposition. But it became a real opposition because a lot of people that were hosts weren't going to go along with the destruction of the country. And so Roger Ailes wouldn't punish and fire people like Sean Hannity. But now you're going to see the hatchet come down, folks. Absolute tyranny. And you're going to see Hillary try to steal the election. We're seeing the real fall of this country right now. America's fighting for its life. Now, Paul Joseph Watson will be joining us from London, taking over for 2 hours. Then Jakari Jackson is taking over because I've got to get ready for the 28-hour marathon transmission, and quite frankly, we just bit off more than we could chew with the RNC and DNC and the size of our crew, everything else we're doing. We normally have weeks to get ready for these 28-hour broadcasts. We started getting ready Friday. I was up here Saturday and Sunday working with Anthony Gucciardi and one of the tech people. Anthony worked till about midnight on Sunday. I'm not complaining or not about having to work. It's just that I've got to get this ready because we've got some big breaking news. We've got a lot more taking place. I've got to make some phone calls. Right now, I know a whole bunch of huge developments that if I could tell you would be probably top stories in the country. And I've pretty much been authorized to talk about this, but it's so big, a lot of this, I kind of hesitate. Because if I don't put it out there just right, I mean, the truth's the truth, but it's how it's put out. Something mega huge almost has no effect. Petty little stupid stuff gets picked up and is huge for some reason, but really important stuff just gets ignored. And I don't know how to describe this. It's surreal to watch Hillary Clinton steal all those states. So I have to go back and get all those states she stole. That's what I'm going to basically take off and do in the next few hours. And go get all the articles and show the states they took and show the states Sanders really won. I got to add up the numbers. We've done this before, but I want to add up the numbers, show the graph so people can see it, and show the New York Daily News article about it. To their credit, they reported on it, and illustrate it for people. We've got to illustrate it for people that Sanders really did win and that the superdelegates have just told everybody, we don't care what you do, starting in New Hampshire, ending in California, we're going to give it to Hillary. And all the articles where they said, look, we don't care, we're going to do it. And the Republicans saying, we don't care, we're going to do it. I've got to somehow, you know, put that out to just ask America, is this really who we are? Because they just hope we're too lazy to get into the minutia of it and understand it's total suspension of the election, but they act like there was an election. It's how the Soviet Union would do things. But really, it's how Communist China does it with a Central Committee and a Politburo. Now, the Bernie people know it, and they're hopping mad. But this is a major referendum on, can you steal a primary? Can you steal an election? And then the big news is the Trump camp has been working late into the night the last few evenings with top experts on this, chronicling Hillary's frauds. And to their credit, just like Trump came out and said, hey, the Republicans are stealing states from me, and the Republicans are trying to say superdelegates count, this is a fraud, that forced them to back off and not try to actually steal it. They said they were, but Trump spoke out, so it backfired. Well, Trump's going to have to speak out about if Crooked Hillary stole this from Bernie, and show the numbers and show the graphs. And if I got to do the work for the campaign, I will, because I know they're going over all of it. We need Trump to come out and say, listen, lady, I'm ahead of you in the polls. Don't you think for a minute you're going to steal jack squat. It's the only thing that'll stop her doing it. And I know they agree with me. But I'm just sitting here just with this feeling of history in front of us. Almost like desperation if in the future I nostalgically look back and haven't done my job. It's like desperation before the fact. It's just totally animating that I shouldn't even be here on the radio. I should be dropping all of this to try to collate and codify all that info. And folks, don't wait for me to do it. You need to put it together.
Thank you.
I mean, this is other media, Daily Caller, WorldNet Daily. I don't care about the credit. We got to put the case on. It's a fact. It's already been admitted. We got to show it. People ask me, do I get on a power trip with the fact that InfoWars is the leading edge, tip of the spear against globalism? And no, it's the opposite. But my mom, I was talking to her on the phone yesterday, and she said, I'm so glad to hear you're at least excited and happy for the first time in years when it comes to talking about the state of the world. Because I know we're losing. I know we're under total world government. I know they're horribly evil and the public's in a trance. But I have been celebrating a little bit in the last few days because I already knew this from sources, but I confirmed in the highest levels of the resistance in Europe, Russia, and here in the United States that what I'm seeing on the street is what they're seeing, and that I'm not only influencing in my crews, I'm only influencing with general public and helping awaken them, not telling them what to see, but taking the blinders off, but that also world leaders, as I already knew, but I've confirmed across the board, listen to this broadcast, whether it's the UK government or the Syrian government or the Russian government or the Japanese government or the South African government, I mean, it is mind-blowing. And that's what one of these major leaders just kept telling me. They said, listen, it's the same way. You don't realize when you're fighting how big an effect you're having until you finally go through the storm. And it's not a feeling like, oh, I won the football game. That's such an empty feeling. Stupid. It's like at least I'm struggling and I'm in the fight and we may have a chance. But then... you get desperate, like, and you're like, I want to do this, I want to do that. And it's all this number crunching and all this documentation and, you know, all this digging the info up that you already see and know, and it's just like, And then you want other people around you to have the same energy. But they aren't going to have it until they're out of the trance. Because most people are in a trance from entertainment and the culture. They're in fantasy land. All the archetypes in their mind and soul are tied to things growing up that were based in fantasy. So their passion is in fantasy. Their passion is in fiction. Their passion is in sports. That's a vestigial ceremonial combat. And so they are just spectators. But we can't be mad at the general public because slowly they're coming out of that. But I'll tell you this, history's actors that are in opposition to the planetary dictatorship and the eugenics program, they're on the same page as InfoWars because InfoWars is a clear-eyed, historically based, researched battlefield analysis compendium and a chronicle of the human struggle. And then there's the responsibility, not a power trip. That you're doing a terrible job, but you're the best there is. And I was talking to some highly decorated special forces soldiers, famous in their work, not Tim Kennedy, some other guys. One guy with more kills than Chris Kyle, Army. And I said, well, when I think about this, I get tears in my eyes. And then it's embarrassing about what we're up against and the fact that we could beat it. People would just wake up. And they said, no, that's what everybody who's out there doing everything, putting everything into it. And then you're sad that people are unconscious and aren't awake and don't know what's going on. And it's a feeling of pain for humanity. And it's just so incredible that when you actually talk to seasoned soldiers, they're the most awake, involved human people you will ever meet. And that's why the left and the dehumanizers hate them. And on average, cops are the same way, despite all their problems and the bad. That's why the globalists hate them, because these are still real people. All right, I'm about to hand the baton to Paul Watson, because I have got to go meet with crew about the 28-hour broadcast that I'm going to be hosting. I don't know, like 10 hours of or more coming up, kicking off at 11 a.m. tomorrow. I then have to get on the telephone, obviously, to New York and get the latest intel on what's going on with the globalist and Hillary's operations. I've got to tell you right now, some of the folks like Roger Stone have amazing intel. So it's come out in the WikiLeaks now that Hillary was sending the Bernie people dressed up like Bernie Sanders supporters to attack Trump supporters, that they were trying to blame Bernie and Trump at the same time. And that came from Stone's sources inside the Democratic Party. Stone exposed the Koch brothers were funding Hillary. That now has come out 6 months later, and the exact numbers he put out. I mean, he's got moles everywhere. And he doesn't even want me to get into the stuff, actually, that he's been going through. Just to say that incredible IRS stuff, all of a sudden, computers broken into, threats. I mean, this is a real war, folks. This is not a game. We're not playing tiddlywinks here. They are coming after the Second Amendment. They're coming after the First Amendment, but they first have to steal this election. And we need a total landslide to defeat the fraud they'll be engaged in. The good news is Donald Trump is not going to roll over if there's fraud. And Hillary better understand that and better know that. And so that's where we're going here. But if we get the word out and explain to people and go back to the news articles from New Hampshire and California and eight other states, 10 total, admittedly, where Sanders won by huge margins, 20 or more points per state, admitted, and so they just said it doesn't matter, superdelegates. And we have superdelegates bragging about it. We have the Republicans trying it. And they just hope you forget about all that. No. This is a referendum on do we have voting in this country and do votes count? It's never been clear. So many people thought Bernie Sanders was going to get up there last night. I heard people calling in and the news saying, what will he do? Will he do a Ted Cruz? No. He's with the establishment. Ted Cruz is with the establishment. The Democratic Party, the Republican Party, the Koch brothers, the Rockefeller Foundation, George Soros. They're all against Donald Trump. And if you don't support Donald Trump, you're a moron. It has never been clearer that Donald Trump is taking the globalists for a run for their money and going all out. And I can tell you, ladies and gentlemen, that Donald Trump has pledged to me directly. I'm going to just stop right there. That he is going to fight the New World Order, and he knows what's going on. He's aware of it, and he's never backing down. And that's what it comes down to. Just the issues he's talking about and the things he's covering and saying are irrevocable, damaging to the globalist. Now, here is Bernie Sanders being booed last night. I'm with her. I mean, she is the Goldman Sachs, J.P. Morgan candidate, and he won by massive percentage points. I mean, you can break them all down, but it doesn't matter. Superdelegates decided, the party decided, for the first time in U.S. history, and he went up there and went along with it. Here it is.
And we have got to elect Hillary Clinton and Tim Kaine.
They're going to finish busting the borders up and bringing in globalism. And the whole thing boos him. Elizabeth Warren got booed.
Brothers and sisters.
Oh, look, the Politburo is not going along.
Brothers and sisters.
Oh, they don't like their votes not counting? Next, they'll say it's a conspiracy theory that Bernie ever even existed. Just like, you know, when your name's Ali and you yell Allah Akbar and pledge allegiance to ISIS and blow people up, BBC comes out and says, your name's not Ali, it's David. And I guess David Johnson or David Wilhelm or David Pierre, I'm just random names, David John Doe cut off the head and stabbed the nuns in France today. In Normandy. We're going to go to Paul Watson now, but I wanted to play one more clip. This is just classic here. This is the comedian, Sarah Silverman, what she said about Hillary previously, what she's saying now, the total flip-flop. Here it is.
So let's talk politics, because okay. I know you care deeply and you've been a Bernie supporter.
Well, she cares deeply.
I am a Bernie supporter.
Bernie.
With gusto.
Hillary takes money from banks and big business and super PACs. So did Barack Obama. She's no different than anybody else. She was the best choice.
Yes, she is. She's worse.
Considering they all do it. Then someone came along who doesn't take steroids.
Can I just say to the Bernie or bust people, you're being ridiculous.
She has Al Franken up there.
Not playing the game. And says what he means.
I am proud to be a part of Bernie's movement, and a vital part of that movement is making absolutely sure that Hillary Clinton is our next president of the United States. Booyah, Baba Booey.
What? Listen to what you did. This is a comedian. This is the power of comedy.
Thank God they can fix this in post.
So there you go. Paul Joseph Watson, we have entered a twilight zone here, my friend. I want to ask Paul Watson this question as I hand the baton to him. And then Jakari Jackson is going to be co-hosting in the fourth hour. I'll be back tomorrow, 28 hours, kicked off at 11 a.m. Central. They won't call jihadis terrorists. They won't say it's Islamic. Now they change their names from Ali to David. I mean, I have the BBC screenshots here. They openly steal the election. You're going on a well-deserved vacation tomorrow, but I need your help to go back to the New York Daily News, how they admitted that they met in secret, decided that Hillary would win, even though Bernie was getting more votes, and then just ignored the election in California. He got 20% more, but she got more delegates in New Hampshire and eight other states. I've done the math. We've covered it. They admit he's really the winner. You see the vast majority support him, but now they have these new superdelegates that are ignoring it. To me, that's the epic issue, to actually do an article showing those numbers to people again, kind of a post-mortem. And you know, we have an article out today where the Washington Post is trying to cover that up. To me, this is the key. And then the big question is, if they're going to steal the nomination, they're going to go after Trump. And Trump knows that. So what do we do? What do we expect? But it's so Twilight Zone, where the level of their deception and lying is something I've never even seen. It's like five times worse. Is this desperation? Is it backfiring? Where do you think we're going in all of this madness? But at the same time, they're being honest, Paul, saying, hey, we are going to ban your guns, and the stock market is rigged, and mega elites don't pay taxes, so sit down and take it. I mean, is this just the arrogant political class and the whore media thinking they're invincible? Because they're not, Paul.
I think it's a hangover from, you know, legacy media in general, Alex. They're still under this illusion that they can completely control the narrative, that they control all sources of information. Mainstream media is completely pathetic. Not only is it not trusted, it's slow, it's inaccurate. I mean, if you're following a breaking news event, you don't watch BBC, you don't watch CNN, you go on Twitter. They report everything 30 minutes to an hour beforehand, and usually it's more accurate because it's not being covered up. I mean, today with this priest beheading, which I'm going to talk about, you know, 2-3 hours after it happened, after we knew that the attackers were shouting Allah Akbar, they were shouting pro-ISIS slogans, they were wearing Muslim garb, they were beheading priests. Where else have we seen that? Gee, I wonder. The BBC, 3 hours after, were still saying the motive isn't known. Completely pathetic. In fact, it's a running joke. There's a joke headline now, which is on the, you know, a mock-up of the BBC website. It says, clumsy French priest stumbles upon peaceful Muslim's butter knife and accidentally beheads himself. That's the level that it's got to. Remember with the Germany suicide bombing, they were like, Syrian migrant dies in blast, not suicide bomber blows himself.
They actually said that. That's not a joke headline. So here's what I'm getting at. If the media will go this far, they will sit there and lie if we're put in FEMA camps and killed and say we never existed. I mean, they're now getting to that level. How do they get an entire industry of people to engage in such bizarre criminal behavior? I mean, it's criminal to cover up this jihad offensive.
Because if they don't parrot the narrative, the consensus, they get fired. I mean, the head of German ZDF, their top broadcaster, came out a few months ago and said, look, we report what the German government tells us to report. Period. That's it. They're state media. It's just they don't admit to being state media. It's just it's almost as bad as Chinese state media. At least they admit to it. You know, we've got a BBC that fails to report on known details for hours afterwards. So they can claim there was no known motive. So they can claim, oh, this guy didn't have Ali in his name. He was influenced by Anders Breivik. This was a right-wing inspired attack. For hours after that shooting in Munich, they were just obsessing about Anders Breivik.
That's right. I forgot to mention that they don't just cover up the Ali or the Muhammad in the names. They then, again, call him David and then blame the right wing and actually say the right wing did it. Why don't they just say that John Wayne did it, for that matter?
They've got a narrative to push, and they push it after every single attack, which is why nobody trusts them. You know, what was it, down to 5% media trust in the recent polls? People are turning away from them in droves. That's why our traffic's gone up, because they're simply not credible anymore. We've warned that these attacks would happen over and over again. We specified the reasons why.
And that's my next question. Now it's accelerating as part of a jihad worldwide offensive that their imams are openly proclaiming worldwide, that Saudi Arabia is funding. Where does it go next? And how does the West think it's going to get away with this? The Western leaders.
They're not going to get away with it. You had Valls in 2013, the French prime minister, saying it's okay that we allow jihadists in and out of France. Again, this the guy who beheaded the priest today tried to go to Syria to fight for ISIS last year, was stopped in Turkey, was able to get back into France. 2 years before that, the French Prime Minister said, we don't care about these jihadists coming back and forth because they're fighting Assad. Now, that's not the only problem. Obviously, Islam's a violent and intolerant religion. That's their inspiration. But not overthrowing secular leaders in the Middle East would be a start. But as you mentioned earlier in the show, this attitude, you know, after Paris, it was all hug a Muslim and everybody was cuckolded. After Nice, they were booing and hissing at the president, the prime minister. Even the BBC today reports that the mood has turned noticeably sour again after this attack. So it remains to be seen. I mean, the head of the French police came out and said, one or two more terror attacks, there'll be riots on the streets. There'll be, quote, civil war. You've got local council members saying that people are buying guns. They're joining gun clubs in record numbers.
And that's the prime minister being booed when he said at the funeral, we've got to accept this. And again, that's to break your will. Why would you go to a funeral and say, accept being murdered? Because this is their, what Bracken pointed out is what the Muslims do in these countries, especially Wahhabis. They tell leaders, we're going to pay you off. We're going to put you in office. We're going to protect you when we take over. But you've got to let us start killing people and cover it up to prove you're our demi. So I didn't realize it was a cult gang initiation is why the Germans and the French and the Swedes and others, folks in Finland, if you defend yourself, you get put in prison. This is the criminals breaking our will, Paul.
And you notice that the solution to the problem of bringing in millions of Muslim migrants is to turn Western society into basically a Sharia law situation. You've got yet another story today where this group of Muslims go to a nude bathing swimming pool in Germany and start chanting Allah Akbar. They start yelling at the young people there simply for their choice that they want to bathe nude.
And really, they're just a bunch of perverts when they get in control, raping and murdering. They just want to actually come and see it because they get off on it, but then dominate it and control it because it's a culture of rape and torture and pedophilia and devil worship.
Dozens of cases in England, other countries of Muslim pedophile gangs abusing, abducting young children. And they grandstand on this supposed virtuous moral platform. As you said, they're the most wicked. They're the most deviant when it comes to those kind of situations. So they chanted at these women, quote, German women are all sluts. And basically they threatened to, quote, exterminate them while chanting Allah Akbar. But what's the solution? It's not to stop allowing in millions of people who hold these beliefs, which are intolerant and not progressive, even though the progressives defend them. The solution is to have segregated swimming pools. The solution is to have segregated trains.
That's right. Make us go under Sharia law. That's the plan. I heard this from people 10 years ago. I didn't believe it. I have to say they're correct. I have to say it's true. There is no doubting it. Paul, I'm going to turn over the rest of the broadcast to you. Please, listeners, it is so important for everyone to remember that it's absolutely, totally critical that you support the broadcast. We now have an in-game response to Karl Rove, 1%. We're an empire creating our own reality for you to study. Study's over. You're under arrest. Washington blog, I've had enough of these war murderers and created poverty that annually kills millions. And the reason I asked for this article is he told the New York Times and Washington Post, and while you're studying that reality judiciously, as you will, we'll act again, creating our new realities, which you can study too, and that's how things will sort out. We're history's actors now, and you, all of you, will just be left to just study what we do. That's why the BBC says that David Jones, this is bizarre, the most common British name, David Bowie's name, my dad's name, murdered these people or blew them up. When they got that guy's name's Ali Mabubu or whatever it is. In fact, if you look up the name, it's Ali something. I mean, this is getting, but it's on purpose to break our will and just say that blonde haired women raped everybody in Cologne and order the police to say so. And a German minister gets raped by four Muslims. She says German men did it. She was happy to frame Germans with it. It's a self-hate, just evil. We're fighting back, ladies and gentlemen, and we're running a special through the 28-hour broadcast of 40% off Brain Force, the ultimate nootropic. I know Paul talks about it, gives it rave reviews. Third-party sites give it 4.8 stars. It is amazing. It's already very inexpensive, super high-quality nootropic. Or you can pay full price. You can also get 10% off with when you sign up for AutoShip, free shipping on orders $50 or more, 20% off Survival Shield X2, 20% off Supermel Vitality, and a lot of other specials at InfoWarsStore.com or InfoWarsLife.com to go directly to nutraceuticals, or call toll-free 888-253-3139. But I want to just remind the listeners and thank them for their support. We're able to cover Bilderberg and cover RNC, DNC, and all these other events, and always have reporters in the field around the world breaking major news, exposing the open borders, exposing criminal Hillary supporter operatives saying they're going to ban guns, getting the inside scoop, showing the communists calling for violence, showing Black Lives Matter. Who is fighting like this? Just know, when you buy our products, you are literally the fuel, the oxygen, the energy, the Energon cubes that power this operation. So whether it's storable foods or non-GMO seeds or crank shortwave radios or super high-quality nutraceuticals or books and films and Molon Labe and Hillary for Prison t-shirts, all of this is key. And when you purchase the products, we're able to put up flying banners that are flying in different parts of the country right now, Hillary for Prison, InfoWars.com. It's all symbiotic. Thank you for your support. InfoWarsStore.com. And join us tomorrow. Join us tomorrow, 11 a.m. Central, for the 28-hour kickoff. 24 hours for the start of the next show, then 4 more hours of live transmission. Operation Sleeping Giant, InfoWars.com/giant to find all the free feeds and more. We're going to add the satellite uplink feed to that for radio and TV. If your station wants to carry all or part of it, it's free to air. Put ads over it. Do whatever you want. Air clips of it on your shows. We are copyright free with our info. We're in a war. 22 hours, 32 minutes, 34 seconds out. Please help us spread the word. Please help us reach out to folks in your area. Please get this intel out to everyone you know. Paul Watson, you're going to be hosting for another hour and about 35 minutes, 5 minutes into the 2 o'clock hour, then Jakari Jackson comes in to take over for the balance of that hour. Then the nightly news tonight, 7 o'clock Central. And of course, you'll probably be taking calls as well. Paul, I'm going to go ahead and hand the baton to you from London, England.
Okay, thanks, Alex. And we've got David Knight coming up in a little while with an update from the DNC. So look out for that. The top of the hour, we have Tommy Robinson, activist, author, of course, has received numerous death threats and physical assaults for talking about the religion of peace, to talk about what has unfolded today in Normandy, France. Again, the sun came up this morning, so the religion of peace has struck again. It's gallows humor, but it's virtually every single day now that this happens. And bear in mind, we've got a political class, we've got a media that tells us every single day, and in fact, Trevor Noah was on MSNBC trying to make this point yesterday, that the biggest danger to the West is Donald Trump's politically incorrect rhetoric. That's the biggest danger that we faced as a Western civilization, not a belief system that has sworn to subjugate and kill us, that is killing us on the streets of Europe now nearly every single day. No. That's not a threat. Donald Trump's politically incorrect comments and remarks, that's the biggest threat to the West. We've had a political environment in the UK after Brexit where we've been told over and over again that people saying mean things to Muslims on public transport, so-called hate crimes, so-called Islamophobia, that's the biggest threat we face. Making xenophobic comments on social media, that's the biggest danger that we face. Meanwhile, we have people dying every day on the streets of Europe. We'll be back with the latest. This is The Alex Jones Show. Don't go away. The Alex Jones Show. This is Paul Joseph Watson. We're going to go to the DNC in a moment. We've got David Knight and Joe Biggs on the scene to talk about the revolt against Hillary Clinton and the Democratic establishment by the Bernie Sanders supporters. They kind of created or helped create that monster in the first place to unleash it on Donald Trump, of course. Now it's beginning to blow back in their faces. This is a headline out of Town Hall. Missing topic from DNC day one, ISIS. That's right. They made 60 speeches at the DNC yesterday alone. Not one single mention of ISIS. ISIS has come out today, again, claimed the responsibility for this latest attack almost every single day now we have jihadist attack in Europe. We've had San Bernardino. We've had other incidents in the United States. The DNC has absolutely nothing to say about it. Sky News reports with the latest: slain priest forced to kneel before throat cut. A Catholic priest was forced to kneel by two men armed with knives before they slit his throat, according to a nun who witnessed the deadly attack. This was an 86-year-old priest. He was ordained in the 1950s. Now, first report said that he'd had his throat cut. Later report said that he was beheaded. The murderous pair were neutralized by police as they came out of the church reportedly shouting, "Allah Akbar, nothing to do with Islam." Of course, even before that, we knew that they were dressed in Muslim garb. French authorities were saying it was an Islamist attack. They were shouting pro-ISIS slogans, but for hours. The BBC and other leftist media outlets said, "No known motive for the attack." No known motive for the attack. Perhaps it was Anders Breivik related. Perhaps we can talk about that endlessly for hours and hours. Anything that will allow us to stick our heads in the sand and not face up to the fact that we've got this violent ideology, this poisonous mindset amidst us, and it's killing people every single day. Breitbart is reporting young Muslims threaten nudist bathers with extermination. Again, the religion of peace being so progressive and peaceful towards those who will defend it at every single turn. We have Mexico announcing that it's going to build a border wall, while, of course, you know, Donald Trump is evil, he's racist, he's bigoted, wanting to do the same thing to keep out illegal aliens coming in from Mexico. When Mexico does the same thing to keep out people from Guatemala, that's perfectly fine. The Express is reporting migrant hacked to death in bloodbath at Calais jungle camp. We're going to get into that and a lot more later in the show. Obviously, Tommy Robinson will be joining us to discuss the religion of peace in the aftermath of this latest horrific attack in Normandy, France. But we've got, I believe, David Knight on the line from the DNC. David, you tweeted out a video, which I retweeted, which shows members of the press being handed Michelle Obama and Hillary Clinton signs. And they seemed quite keen to express their support for both of those individuals, correct?
Oh, yeah. You know, Paul, when we were there, Ken and I were up in the bleachers. We were waiting for the various speeches, particularly Bernie. We wanted to get the reaction of the crowd to Bernie. But as each speaker came out, they were handing out signs. So when Cory Booker spoke, they handed out We Will Rise placards that were all printed up. They did the same with each one of the speakers, then handed out the Michelle signs on the sticks. That's what I tweeted out. And of course, this was the press section. And there's a link on the Drudge Report of Kit's video where he actually engaged the employee who was handing them out. He goes, "Do you typically hand out these things in the press section?" She goes, "Yeah, they told us to, so we're doing it." But the point is, they were all taking it very eagerly, and they were all doing it openly. And I have less of a problem with that, quite frankly, than the fact that they've been covertly supporting the DNC and Hillary Clinton while maintaining that they are neutral and objective and not on either side. That's the dishonest part about it. I don't really have a problem with people cheering it on. You can certainly see that they're in the tank for Hillary Clinton, but at least they were open about it last night, unlike they've been for the last several months. Now I've been exposed in the DNC emails. I guess they figured they're just going to come out now being for Hillary.
Now, we compare this to the RNC. Of course, at the RNC, we had relatively few protesters, given the buildup that it had. You know, few actually managed to turn up. In some situations, there were protesters were outnumbered by the cameras. Now at the DNC, according to what I've seen from other people who were there, there are a lot more protesters, yet the media seems completely disinterested in covering the protest. Is that an accurate appraisal?
That's very accurate. I wasn't at the RNC, but everybody who was points that out. And of course, they're very angry. We had a Bernie delegate come over to us and tell us how upset he was about this whole process, that he's a veteran. His son was a veteran. His son was sent to fight in a war that was based on lies. He said, "Why am I killing people based on lies?" they were very upset about a lot of things, TPP and other issues. And he said, I want to talk to you guys. I said, fine. He goes, but not until after we have the roll call vote, because they know that they are taking recriminations against the people who are booing them, people who are holding up handwritten signs about other issues. It is a real divisive floor that we've got here, far more than you saw at the RNC. At the RNC, the person who got booed the most was the person who was trying to create the division, Ted Cruz. Interestingly enough, even though Bernie Sanders is trying to suck up to the Democrat establishment now, his supporters aren't having it. It's flip-flopped exactly the opposite of the way that it was at the RNC.
Now, they partly were responsible, the Democratic Party, the media establishment, the leftist media establishment, for creating this kind of Bernie monster. Now, obviously, you've got a lot of principled Bernie supporters, even if you don't agree with them. But you've also got this more violent bunch, which they, of course, unleashed at the Trump event, which they used to blame Trump for that violence. Now it appears that it's starting to blow back in their faces, correct?
Yeah, I would say so. I mean, the people that we've talked to inside the convention center, people who are delegates, and we're going to be talking to them this evening, is the roll call vote. So we're going to be talking to the disgruntled, disaffected, shut down Bernie Sanders delegates at the convention tonight. But the people we were talking to in the convention, Paul, were pretty articulate. They understood the issues. They were not in total propaganda mode, unlike the Hillary Clinton supporters we talked to. I talked to a woman who was from the Ukraine, basically trying to make the case that we should be starting World War III with the Russians, talking about how Putin was behind the DNC leaks. And, you know, of course, Snowden has shut this down. I think it's interesting. I saw Carl Bernstein from Watergate reporting, of course. And during Watergate, at the height of the Cold War, we never had anybody put out the idea that Russia was behind the Watergate leaks. Okay. They were all, nobody suggested that Deep Throat was a Russian. And yet that's the first place that they jumped. They're trying to cover up the fact that Hillary Clinton's other email scandal was a massive treasure trove of documents to the Russians and anybody else who wanted to read the highest level secrets. And yet they will not make that connection. No matter how many times you pointed out that it's John Deutsch, Bill Clinton's CIA director, that was facing prison terms before Clinton gave him a pardon, how he lost his security clearance. Here they want to elect somebody, and she's going to get a security briefing at the end of the week, even though she's already turned over all the secrets. They said last week when Trump got the nomination, he wasn't going to get the security briefing until after Hillary Clinton got it. And I said, well, you know, at that point, it's not going to be secret anymore. All this stuff is going to be out in the public domain.
No, it's amazing. There was absolutely no concern about China and Russia penetrating Hillary's emails, but then they weave this yarn that Russia is behind this DNC hack with virtually no evidence whatsoever. Another obvious issue that we've got bubbling up is they tried to introduce this DNC convention on the basis of, you know, uniting the party, yeah, in comparison to the RNC, which was, they portrayed it as divisive, you know, a shambolic affair. Now we've had this DNC leak. Do you see the aftermath, the polls? Obviously, the recent polls show Trump edging ahead. Do you think that the DNC, the Democratic Party, will get the same bump in the polls that the Republican Party, that Trump did, given that this whole scandal has clouded the DNC?
I think in public opinion polls, like they're going to, when you look at these conventions, it's 4 days of continuous infomercials and propaganda. They always get a bump in the polls. Question is, how big is it going to be? And I don't think it's going to be that big, especially when you look at things like, Paul, last night I talked to Jesse Jackson on the floor, and I said, you're going to have people here who are family members of black people who've been killed by the police. I said, but you don't have anybody here speaking who are family members of the police who have been killed. And he starts off and he lists out, as we see them do all the time, you pointed it out as well as Alex, I pointed out, they always start with the cases like Michael Brown, where it was ambiguous to start with, or Trayvon Williams, and it was ambiguous to start with, and then they had an investigation. And so they always go with these instead of the ones that are clear-cut, obvious police brutality. So he rattles that off, and I said, yeah, but why don't you have the police stand up? He goes, it's horrible what happened to the police in Dallas. So, well, why don't you have them speak at this convention. He goes, yeah, we should look into it. Look, they were the police chief, not the police chief, but the police union head here in Philadelphia pointed that out last week. I was just giving him the points that the police union chief had made last week. They knew about this. They don't want the police in there. So it's not going to be unifying for the country, Paul. They may be able to unify themselves on the politics, get everybody drummed up playing clips of Mario Cuomo, but they are very divisive, very exclusive to the rest of the country. The whole thing, people are talking about the fact they didn't have any American flags on display last night during the convention. They had a big one up on the Jumbotron monitor in the afternoon, but not during the convention. It wasn't filled with flags like it was with Trump and things like that. So, you know, they have their gods that they worship, and they are very divisive about what they look at. So I don't think they're going to get as big a jump as Trump did.
Okay, David. Final comments. Obviously, we've got this discord amongst Bernie supporters. Do you think that'll be tamped down by these efforts, you know, by, you know, Silverman, all these other people to try and assuage that? Or do you think there will be more rancor? Do you see maybe somebody rushing the stage in the final couple of days of this convention?
I think you're going to see rancor outside of the convention, but they got the convention pretty well under control. I think what you're going to see going forward, Paul, these people that we've talked to there, they really understand the TPP. They're very upset about that, but they can't get themselves, in most cases, to vote for Trump. So they're not going to get anything out of this election. They could get one thing from Donald Trump, and that would be to shut down the TPP. But because of this prejudice, there's this bias that they have, this tribe that they identify with, they won't be able to vote even for that one thing that is a very important issue to them. Most of the people that were there either had a Bernie sign or they had a homemade no TPP sign. They had large signs that they carried in that they put over their laps. So moving forward, that's the key. Are they going to vote for something, or are they just going to be frustrated? This is not part of a movement. I don't think you've seen this guy basically throw his supporters to the side. I don't know what's going on in the background, if they've cut a deal with him, if they're blackmailing him or whatever the deal is, but it is really amazing to see Bernie Sanders betray his supporters. And he was booed yesterday at one of the events when he started talking about Hillary Clinton. They're still very angry about that. I don't think that's going to go away before the election. So they're going to stay home even if they don't vote on the other side. And that's going to hurt Hillary Clinton.
Okay, David, we'll leave it for there. We'll let you switch with Joe Biggs, and then Joe can come in after the break. So we'll allow you to do that there at the DNC with the latest. But for now, we'll continue in the final few minutes with news. And again, we've had yet another jihadist terror attack in Europe every single day now, it seems. We almost went 48 hours without having one. I mean, it was blissful for 48 hours without one of these migrants going jihad, and then it happened again. Now, of course, at the DNC, they're not talking about it. ISIS has not been mentioned once, and the media cover-up is already beginning in the West. Of course, our governments are more outraged about, you know, xenophobic comments on Twitter, racist comments on Facebook, God forbid, people criticizing the mass invasion of migrants flooding into their country. That's what we're told we should be concerned about. This is what we saw in the aftermath of Brexit. Not how are we going to actually leave the European Union now? What does this mean for the future of the country? No, it was, oh my God, there are 30 more incidents of hate crime that have been reported to the police. Again, not actual evidence of hate crime, just reported to the police. Then you look into it. It's, you know, ambiguous graffiti on Polish community centers and things like that. But this is what we're told we should be really concerned about. Xenophobic comments on Twitter, you know, Donald Trump's politically incorrect rhetoric, that's what we should be concerned about. Meanwhile, they're beheading priests. They're plowing through tourists, locals in Nice with trucks. They're machete attacking pregnant women on the streets of Germany. They're axe attacking train passengers in Germany. Almost every day now, every single day nearly, we see this happening, and we see this apologia, not only from the left, but from the mainstream media. Again, the BBC for hours refused to even draw any attention to the fact that these people were obviously Muslims. They were chanting pro-ISIS slogans. Of course, since they've claimed responsibility for the attack, they were chanting Allah Akbar. The BBC reported for hours afterwards, no known motive. Again, go back to the Munich shooting on Friday. They excised out the name of the shooter, Ali, despite the fact that almost every other media outlet included his full name. They took it out. Now, you can talk about the Munich shooting, well, he was bullied, maybe that was a motivation. Certainly, Anders Breivik wasn't a motivation. This guy wasn't some extreme right-wing Christian, okay? But what did the BBC talk about for hours and hours afterwards? Anders Breivik. They're really keen to talk about that, not so keen to talk about the religion of peace. Now, we got more headlines about this, and again, we're coming back, we're going to get Joe Biggs on. But they knew this guy, they had him tagged. He was a convicted terrorist. This is out the Express. One of the two knife men who murdered a priest during a morning mass at a church in Normandy was a convicted terrorist who was known to the French authorities and should have been monitored with an electronic tag. The as-yet unnamed individual attempted to travel to Syria in 2015 to fight with Islamic State, but was arrested in Turkey. It has emerged. And again, why was he allowed to get back into France, even though he was arrested in Turkey last year? Well, that's because the French Prime Minister, Manuel Valls, said back in 2013 that France was perfectly okay with allowing these jihadists to move back and forth. He said, quote, "The fighters in Syria are not fighting France or Europe. They're fighting Assad's regime. So as long as they were fighting Assad, a secular leader that was dealing with Al-Qaeda in his own country, they turned a blind eye. It led to Paris. It led to Nice. It led to the beheading of this priest in Normandy." We'll be back on The Alex Jones Show with Joe Biggs after this. Go back. It's The Alex Jones Show live. Coming up in the next hour, we've got author and activist Tommy Robinson to talk about the religion of peace and today's beheading in Normandy, France. But now we've got Joe Biggs on the line from the DNC. Now, Joe, I saw that you crashed a Fox Business broadcast with a Trump sign. Tell us about that. Tell us how this differs to the RNC, which you were at a few days ago.
Well, actually, when I was walking around last night, they were handing out these signs. It says, "Love Trump's hate." And I'm sitting there thinking, why did no one think about this? This is a great idea. I'm going to fold this up and pretty much just walk around. So I just kind of photobombed Fox News Business, CNN with Wolf Blitzer, Chris Hayes on MSNBC. When I went up behind Chris Hayes, they had a conniption fit. They were flipping out. The camera guys are sitting there doing this and like pointing at me, but they couldn't scream because Chris Hayes was live with some other lady. And I was just sitting there just laughing, walking around, you know, but kind of hijacked the whole thing to really bring attention to the fact that, you know, what happened to the DNC last night I thought was pretty horrific. The fact that there was zero patriotism at all happening there whatsoever. All it was they would bring out a Hispanic speaker, and then he would talk about, Donald Trump talks about he wants to deport people like me because he says we're all criminals. No, he said that there were criminals coming across. Then they go, well, Donald Trump made a comment about handicapped people. So then they bring out this handicapped girl, and then she goes, well, he's making fun of me. And then Eva Longoria comes out and goes, well, I have a handicapped sibling. And when Donald Trump said that, he was making fun of my sibling. And the whole crowd sitting there pandering to the whole thing, and they're all laughing and they're screaming and all this stuff. But when you actually were at the RNC, you saw Trump talk about, hey, radical Islam's a problem. Since 2015, over 40,000 people across the world have been killed by radical Islam. And yet people like Black Lives Matter want to talk about and put a magnifying glass on these police killings. You have a better chance of being struck by lightning than you do by being shot by a cop. Now, most of these people who are famously known, like the Michael Browns, they're being held as these heroes under a false narrative. When you actually go back and you look at it all, his hands weren't up. And he had just got done robbing a store. And he charged at the officer. And yet they still run around screaming, hands up, don't shoot. You know, the stuff that we see at the DNC is complete and total BS. The fact that the DNC leaks can come out and Debbie Wasserman Schultz can be behind it. Then Hillary Clinton comes out right afterwards and says that Debbie Wasserman Schultz did everything she could to get me to the point where I am. Pretty much admitting to the fact that the DNC was putting her in the position to throw Bernie out of the way and for her to take over and get the nomination. And then what does Hillary Clinton do? She makes her the honorary chairman of her campaign. Wasserman Schultz. So it's completely and totally ridiculous, the amount of corruption. But when you have nothing on someone, all they do is go, Trump's sexist, he's racist, blah, blah, blah. He said something that hurt my feelings. And that's all they have. We can go on for days and days and emails and classified emails to prove the corruption at the DNC and with Hillary Clinton.
Exactly. I mean, sexist, bigoted remarks are replete in those DNC leaked emails anyway. So again, complete hypocrisy. There were no American flags there, basically. You were in Iraq, you were in Afghanistan. They had 60 speeches and didn't mention ISIS once. In the final minute, give us your closing comments, Joe Biggs.
Yeah, exactly. The largest threat right now to us in the world is radical Islam. And all they want to do is bring up speaker after speaker to talk about how Donald Trump hurt their feelings. That is ridiculous. There are more important things than your feelings right now, like maybe your life, like maybe getting killed in a hatchet attack or being blown up or shot to death by radical Islam, and the fact that the Dems want to take your guns away and not give you the ability to protect yourself from those radical jihadists.
Okay, Joe Biggs and David Knight there at the DNC. We will look forward to more coverage from you. Thanks for joining us. After the break, Tommy Robinson is coming up. We're going to delve more into this beheading in Normandy. We're going to talk about the religion of peace and if the French people, if the German people will finally have some kind of reaction to this horror. We'll be back on The Alex Jones Show. Don't go away. Final hour of The Alex Jones Show. We got Tommy Robinson coming up. Of course, we had yet another horrific attack in Normandy, France today. A priest beheaded another hostage in critical condition. Thankfully, the police in that area were able to respond quickly and shot the two assailants dead. But of course, it's just the latest in a long line of attacks. We had the axe attack on a train in Germany. We had the machete attack on the streets of Germany. We had the Syrian migrant suicide bomber who blew himself up outside a restaurant bar after he had tried to enter a music festival. Thankfully, he only succeeded in killing himself. That attack could have been far worse. And then today's outrage. But of course, our governments, as I've said, are more outraged about xenophobic comments on Twitter than they are about Islamists killing us every single day. Let that sink in. The amount of resources, the amount of attention they're devoting to hunting down alleged racists who make mean remarks on social media. Again, that gets the visibility. That gets the play in terms of mainstream media narrative. What doesn't get the play, or doesn't get any attention whatsoever, in this conversation about why we keep being attacked, is the fact that in France, Muslims, 35% of them, across all Muslims living in France, support suicide bombings. 42% of Muslims aged 18 to 29 support suicide bombings. So don't tell me that it's a tiny fringe radical minority. Yes, the ones who actually go out and slaughter people are, but the support network around them, the Islamist buffer zone around them, as we saw with Abdeslam in Molenbeek, Brussels, they protect them, they support them. This problem goes way deeper than, quote, jihadists, as we see in Germany with the story I mentioned earlier. A group of six Muslims, again, go to this nudist bathing pool, start chanting Allah Akbar, start harassing all the people there, start saying, you're all sluts, we're going to exterminate you. Again, this is cultural enrichment. This is diversity. This is refugees welcome. Attacking the very core supposedly progressive principles of the carefree lifestyle that leftists want to lead. But of course, they're okay to do it because in the oppression Olympics league table, they rank above everyone else. I mean, I made the point in my video yesterday, which we're going to play later in the show if we've got time. Imagine if right-wing neo-Nazi skinheads were literally killing people on the streets of Europe every day. Imagine if they were going to events and harassing women, molesting women. Imagine if they were beheading imams at mosques throughout Europe. Imagine if they were driving trucks through crowds of Muslims praying on the street. What would the media narrative be? Would they analyze the hateful ideology that was inspiring, that was motivating those kind of attacks? Well, of course they would. They even try to do that when it has nothing to do with the right wing. So, of course, they would be completely obsessed with that. It would be right-wing apocalypse descending on the West. But when Muslims do it, we can't talk about that. We just have to hug a Muslim, keep saying that it's a tiny, radical, fringe minority, even though it's not. I mean, how many attacks is it going to take? Are we going to have 10 attacks a day for people to finally recognize that this is not a tiny minority, that this is not a religion of peace? Can we reform the religion of peace? Is it beyond that? Given that, nobody. They can't gather together 12 people to have a not in my name protest after these Islamic terror attacks, but they can have riots globally after somebody draws a damn cartoon. Can we reform Islam? Or is it completely impossible? We're going to talk about that with Tommy Robinson on The Alex Jones Show Live after the break. Stay tuned. Breaking news at Infowars.com. We're back. It's The Alex Jones Show Live. We've got Tommy Robinson coming up here in a minute. But first, I want to draw your attention to Operation Sleeping Giant. This is the special 28-hour broadcast that launches tomorrow to help us break the globalist stranglehold on free humanity. This is 28-hour broadcast, again, begins tomorrow with the main show, continues for 24 hours after the main show, and it's going to take place in the middle of Queen Hillary's coronation at the DNC, again, on Wednesday, July 27th. Be sure to tune in for Operation Sleeping Giant, again, for that marathon broadcast. More details at Infowars.com. And we've got fresh in stock the Bill Clinton rape t-shirt. If you thought that Hillary for prison was a conversation starter, then just wait for this. Of course, this was the t-shirt that triggered Cenk Uygur of the Young Turks during that infamous confrontation with Alex Jones with Infowars at the RNC. It's going to trigger a lot of other people too. It's going to be a massive conversation starter. And of course, your purchase goes to support us, to support the outreach, to enable us to fly people at great expense to all these global media events to take on the mainstream media narrative face to face. So that is the Bill Clinton rape t-shirt. And again, of course, alleged rapist. It's not as if he flew around on a private jet with a convicted pedophile and underage sex trafficker, Jeffrey Epstein. That didn't happen. But get the Bill Clinton rape t-shirt at InfowarsStore.com. Now we're joined by activist, author, Tommy Robinson. Of course, we've had this horrible attack today. Tommy, I just want to get your initial reaction to the beheading of the priest. You know, we've got BBC telling us that calling a terrorist might be politically incorrect. How much blood running through the streets of European cities will it take before our leaders actually identify the root cause of this problem?
I don't think our leaders are going to. I don't think it's going to come from our leaders. I think it's going to have to eventually come from the people. When we look at this most recent attack, it's daily now. It's daily. But still we see the same reactions. When you look at what's recently gone on, you look at all these terrorist attacks, you look at Nice, you look to Germany, you look to today, you look at everything that's gone on. There's still ships going and bringing more refugees in as this is happening. Every day. There's not like any steps have been taken at all to fortify or protect the citizens of Europe. We're still bringing people in. We don't know who they are. Was it yesterday, today? There's been a murder in the Calais jungle, in the refugee camp in Calais, where those people who are committing that murder and committing these robberies and committing this violence will soon be in the back of a lorry and jumping out of the M25 or jumping out in Todderton just 10 minutes from my house. These is still happening. Nothing's been done. So nothing's changed. And when you talk about what will our leaders do, Lee Rigby got beheaded. David Cameron set up a government task force who had a five-year plan. And I remember saying at the start of that five-year plan, we're going to be in a worse situation in 5 years. You're not going to solve anything. During those 5 years, we've allowed 2,000 British Muslims to go fight and train with ISIS. We've allowed 450 of them to come back. I believe today's terrorist was walking around with a tag on his ankle, electronic tag. He's a terrorist. He's already a convicted terrorist. We know he's a terrorist. What is he doing walking the streets of our cities with us waiting to be targeted?
No, that's right. I mean, the French Prime Minister Valls, you know, a couple of years ago said, listen, we know these jihadists are coming in and out of the country. They're going to Syria to fight for ISIS. We're just going to let them back in because we want to overthrow ISIS. They're not attacking France or Europe. Well, now they are. You know, you talked about the migrant attack. We've got people in these migrant attack camps hacking each other up because of their inner tribal differences, you know, between Afghans and Northern Africans. I mean, if they have that kind of behavior towards each other, even though they're all Islamists, I mean, Lauren Southern went to the Calais camp and they were saying, yeah, we have actual ISIS supporters here. And what are they going to do when they come into the West? Well, we know what they're going to do because they're doing it almost every day. We got 21% of Syrian migrants, according to polls, support ISIS. 21%. We've got over 1 million, you know, coming into Germany. Not all of them are Syrian. A lot of them are economic migrants taking advantage of it. But 21% of the Syrians alone support ISIS. We've got 35% of Muslims living in France support suicide bombings. So when they say, oh, it's just a tiny minority, why are you painting, castigating all Muslims? Well, you know, Tommy, I made the point earlier. After somebody draws a stupid cartoon of Muhammad, they're out globally rioting. But after every single Islamic terror attack, how many Muslims are out on the streets protesting? How many of them are out there saying, not in my name? Basically, there's none.
There's none. And you've just made the point again. Like, for example, the attack recently on the train in Germany. Yeah? I spoke to people I know and I see on their day-to-day. I said, did you hear about the attack last night? Did you hear about the attack yesterday? No. I talked to them then about the pregnant Polish woman who was butchered to death by another Syrian refugee. No. People haven't even heard of them. Yeah. So the media is, and when the media plays a clever game by just using headlines like Syrian migrant killed by German blast, most people only read the headline. Most people only read and flip through the news and read the headline. So I heard you making the point just as I was about to join this show. Imagine two white men, Englishmen or European men, Frenchmen or German men, walked into a mosque, got the imam out and chopped his head off. Imagine the outcry, the uproar, the world uproar in every country, the protests, everything. Imagine the reaction to it. And then there's nothing in comparison. And then when we talk about, so then we hear the argument that, well, actually, the Polish pregnant girl who was murdered, she was in a previous relationship with this man. That's where we differ. We are bringing in, well, Angela Merkel brought in 1 million young fighting age Muslim men who are culturally different to us. Morally, ethically, their belief system is the opposite to ours. Right and wrong are completely different. There was a girl in Sweden who had petrol poured over her and was burned to death because she finished a relationship with an Afghan refugee. Because in his country, you can't finish that relationship. We're bringing in people and putting ourselves in danger, putting our communities in danger. We have no hold over who they are, what their beliefs are. As you said, when you go through the statistics, it's terrifying. And the demographical change that's currently happening in Europe, America should be watching, the world should be watching, you should be learning from what's happening. But still we see the world divided where we still have these people. I had today a BBC journalist message me 20 minutes after a beheading of a priest, messaging me saying how disgusting it is that hate crime is on the rise. Like I'm supposed to be bothered or care that someone's got a dirty look on a train or on a bus. Because that's the problem. And they make more of a deal is made by the media. Just recently you had two men in England who put some bacon on a mosque door handle. They've been sentenced to 9 months in prison. They're in prison now, probably being beaten by Muslim gangs because they control our prison systems, because our prison systems are like ISIS training camps. They're being beaten for simply putting bacon. Now, it's a pretty stupid thing to have done, yeah? And so is hate crime, but it's speech. No one's getting hurt. But yet we're coming down and stamping down, and the authorities will crush anyone who dares to do any of these things. Now, I don't see any, I get so angry and so frustrated daily at what's happening and the path we're being led down, because we're all going to have to pick up the pieces of this mess that our liberal, pathetic, weak leaders have got us into. And they're still continuing. It's not like, and the problem you'll face, which Europe will face, and it's going to happen, and God forbid, I don't want it to happen, But it will happen. At some point, Europeans are going to react to this. Now, the reason why they react to it in a disgusting, barbaric way, which will happen, is because when there's no light at the end of the tunnel, when no one sees a political solution, when they don't see their police force or their military or their leaders or anybody stepping in to deal with this problem, to put their citizen safety first, first and foremost, the safety must be of European citizens, not helping people from Libya, Syria, Afghanistan, Iraq, people who despise our culture and our way of life. Your job as our leaders, you're elected by us to keep us safe. You failed to keep a priest safe today. You failed by putting an electric tag on a terrorist rather than interning him and putting him in a prisoner of war camp, which is where he should be. We are at war. We are at war, and it's a war we will not win if we can't even identify who we're fighting. And we can't even begin to take all these liberal, pathetic ways of dealing with these terrorists, these ways of dealing with this pure hatred and vile poison, by putting an electric tag on their ankles, by sending them on courses and rehabilitation courses, anti-extremism courses. The most recent terrorist in Australia had just finished his anti-radicalisation programme. It's pathetic. And what you will see and what we will see, if Marine Le Pen was in power, would a terrorist be walking around France with a tag around his ankle? No, he wouldn't. No, he wouldn't. And it's about time we got rid of these weak, pathetic leaders and replace them with people who will put their country's people first. Their safety, their security, their military. Their people need to come before anything else. Rant over.
It'd be an improvement, wouldn't it, Tommy? I mean, you talk about bowing down to these people. It only seems to make them more emboldened. I mean, we had a headline last year, lesbian Swedish bishop wants Christian crosses removed from church to please Muslims. She didn't want to offend the precious Muslim migrants, so she had all the crosses removed. That didn't seem to help today, did it? You mentioned how the media would react if, you know, some right-winger killed someone on the street. Well, we saw it with Joe Cox. You know, 2 weeks of blanket coverage because one mentally unstable person kills somebody on the street. They used it to try and swing the Brexit vote. There were mass protests. At her memorial, they were politicking. They were pushing to remain in the European Union, basically dancing on her grave before she was buried. That was a 2 week media saturation exercise. This beheading today is going to be forgotten about tomorrow. We'll be back on the Alex Jones Show with Tommy Robinson. Don't go. We're live on the Alex Jones Show with Tommy Robinson, talking about the religion of peace after this latest Islamist atrocity in Europe. Well, you know, Hillary Clinton tweeted, quote, "Muslims are peaceful and tolerant people and have nothing whatsoever to do with terrorism." Really, Hillary, is that why 35% of Muslims in France support suicide bombings? Is that why amongst Muslims in France aged 18 to 29, 42% of them support suicide bombings? Yeah, it sounds really peaceful to me. You know, I guess the Pope didn't wash enough migrants' feet. I guess maybe that offended them. Listen to this out of the BBC. This is not The Onion. This is the BBC. This is what they reported today. With 4 attacks in southern Germany coming shortly after the mass murder of 84 people in Nice, counter-terrorism officials are struggling to detect a common thread. Is there a single defining feature to these attacks that could offer clues on how to prevent more of them from happening? On the surface, the answer would appear to be no. The truck driver in Nice was known to have had psychiatric problems and violent outbursts, yet he had a clear enough head to keep his plans hidden for months. Tommy, they're openly, I mean, this is not The Onion, this is actually the BBC. They're saying, could there be a common thread between all these attacks in Germany? All these attacks in Nice, is there a clue that we could somehow find to stitch together why these vicious attacks are happening? Completely insane. They don't even mention Islam. Never mind, you know, push it to the front of the conversation. They don't even mention it. You know, for hours after this attack today, Tommy, they were talking about, they were saying there was no known motive. You've got Muslims shouting Allah Akbar, beheading people, shouting pro-ISIS slogans. That was all reported. The BBC said no known motive. Tommy, I guess it must be the priest's fault, right? He must have slipped over and decapitated himself on the Islamist bread knife.
Out of the 5 attacks, 100% of the attackers have been Muslim. 60% have been refugees. Yeah, there's a link. There's a link. It's hard not to laugh when you hear that. That's our taxpayer money paying for that nonsense. That's our taxpayer money. And when you talk about, even like, for example, the refugee who chopped the pregnant Polish girl up in Germany, he'd been in trouble with the police already. If you've got refugees coming into Europe who are getting into trouble with the police and breaking the law, they need to be booted straight out. They're not refugees, they're invaders. We know that. They're fake refugees. But they need to be booted straight out. The BBC, to be honest, Paul, what I do now is, after anything, for the truth in what's happening, I look to yourself, I look to Rahini Kassan, I look to Breitbart News. Thank God for different now media outlets which are telling us the truth, because so many people are being lied to. That's what I do now. I don't even... Your videos are great and so on point with the points. But I look to... That's where I look. I don't bother looking anywhere else. That's what other people... What we need to understand, we are the media. Each and every one of us are the media. We have to be the media now. Because the mainstream media is just fed and lying, completely lying. And before they tell you who it was or the religion of where they were or why they done it, it's days later. It's days and days later in a snippet. So all the headlines are gone with, we don't know the motive and no one knows the motive. And that's where we're at. People have no idea. And I don't see a solution. So I've been searching for a solution for so long. There isn't any solution to this other than implementing strong, tough laws and trying to de-Islamify Europe. And in doing so, there will be huge conflict. But there will be huge conflict anyway. So I was on another radio show earlier where basically I said, if you tried to ban the burqa now in the UK, you couldn't. The police could not enforce it. They would riot. There would be conflict. Yeah? That's now 4% of the country is Muslim. You tried to ban the full-face niqab. If you tried to do it, if the government tried to do it, they couldn't do it. Yeah? If they did, it would cause huge conflict. And because of that, he said, well, that's what I mean. There's no point in causing more problems. So we're bullied and dictated to when that's 4%. What does anyone, this is just a demographical statistical growth, yeah? Muslims having 5.6 children, we're having 1.3, right? So there are things we can do to combat that and address that, like stopping the benefits for more than two children, because majority of these Muslims are on benefits, 50% of the men and 75% of the women. We're paying for our own demise. So you could try to address these problems, but we're not even trying, we're not attempting. I'm waiting to see what the church leadership, because you see, the church in the UK is very different to the church in America. Our church has been infiltrated by people, many of them, when I listen to them speak, I don't even believe they believe in Jesus Christ or God. I believe they're using the church for their own political sway. Is it not like, for example, the representative of the church in Luton? He's just a complete apologist and supporter of Islam. And Christianity isn't still around all these years later through being weak and pathetic like it is now. That's
okay, Tommy, hold that thought. We'll be back after the break. This is The Alex Jones Show. We'll be right back. We are back on The Alex Jones Show. We're going to go back to Tommy Robinson here in a moment. But first, I just want to remind you about the massive sale coming up. This is one of the biggest sales in our history, if not the biggest, at InfoWarsStore.com. And it will coincide with the marathon epic 28-hour sleeping giant broadcast that starts tomorrow at InfoWars.com and on the air. You can go to InfoWars.com/giant for more information. We're going to have, of course, people on the ground at the DNC in Philly. We're going to have all manner of different hosts bringing you fresh, insightful, different content. So be sure to tune in at InfoWars.com/giant and take advantage of that huge sale at InfoWarsStore.com, where we have fresh in stock the Bill Clinton rape t-shirt that triggered Cenk Uygur in that now infamous confrontation with the Young Turks at the RNC. If you think Hillary for prison was a conversation starter, was a headline maker, then wait until we see the impact of the Bill Clinton rape t-shirt. And you can get that at InfoWarsStore.com. Again, InfoWars.com/giant for all the information on that marathon historic 28-hour broadcast that's set to begin tomorrow. Be sure to join us for that. Now, Tommy, you were talking before the break about
you know, riots. If they banned the burqa, the Muslims would riot in the United Kingdom. You know, it's like in America, they can kill some criminal thug who attacks a cop. People riot over it, and the leftist media supports them. We had Time magazine in defense of rioting. That was their headline. So if people on the left, if so-called minorities have riots, it's a social justice cause, and they're supported by the leftist media. But God forbid, and we're not encouraging it, but I'm not joking when I say the conversation, the narrative in this country is there's more outrage about people being mean to Muslims on a bus than there is actual Islamist atrocities happening throughout Europe. That's not hyperbole, that's real. But if, God forbid, you had some disturbance by Pegida, they would classify it, they would characterize it as some right-wing Nazi apocalypse. If you had anything whatsoever, they would be all over it, framing that in those pejorative terms. But Tommy, there was a comment by old Holborn, who is quite a prolific commentator on Twitter. He said, quote, "Beheading a Catholic priest in a church in France will unleash some serious public disorder. This is a game changer. We've got council members saying that people are joining gun clubs. They're getting weapons in France. We've got the head of the French police saying this is almost about to lead to civil war." Is that likely in your view, or will French people continue to just, you know, curl up in a fetal position and hug a Muslim and hope that everything's going to be okay?
I don't think it's going to happen yet. No, I think that inevitably, yes, they have to do something huge. Unfortunately, one person dying, whether it be a priest or anyone, they're going to have to do something where thousands die, thousands. But then, in order for people to, in our country, everyone's so become so selfish, so selfish for themselves, and so long as they're okay. And they're okay. And even if they've moved out, I see it even with my friends, yeah, who they've made a bit of money and they're all working and they've all got jobs and they're all mortgaged and financed up to the top that they can. They can't step out of line in case their job's affected, in case they lose their career because they'll lose their house, they'll lose this. And they just sit, and as long as they're okay in their house. So all the problems are in Luton. So then everyone leaves Luton and moves to these nice areas. And then they don't care what's happening anymore. And that's what we've created, a generation of selfish cowards. Now, at some point, those people are going to have to realise that the problems that they've moved away from are going to come to where they are. If not where they're going to come to where they are, their children are going to have to deal with them. Now, once people accept that, once the British public understand the reality of Islam and the agenda and what it's going to bring, once people understand that, I believe we'll see a revolution style of a revolution, because people... When the time comes, people will stand up. I always used to think, I've gone through many things, and I used to convince myself, when I was leading the English Defence League, I convinced myself that if they kill me, it's going to be the final thing in this country, because defining moments change the direction of a country's history. Bloody Sunday changed the direction of not Northern Ireland. Who knows what that moment's going to be? If it's not a soldier being beheaded like Lee Rigby, if it's not a Catholic priest being beheaded in his church, what the hell is it going to be? When are people going to rise up? When are people going to stand up? When are people going to look at themselves and take a hard, long look at themselves? And every Englishman or every European man who's watching this and reading this and listening to this, when are you going to do so? What are you going to do? If you can't, everyone has a role to play. I'm not saying go out and start rioting, start killing, start kicking off. But people, even when marches are organised or rallies are organised, people are scared to go on them. Well, you can't be scared. And it frustrates me even at my own country's men. It just frustrates me. I think, what have we become? When you look at our history and you look where we come from and you look at our forefathers and what people gave and sacrificed in order to hand down this beautiful country to us, this beautiful lifestyle, this beautiful freedom, and you're just letting it all go. We're letting it go bit by bit by bit. And the future, Americans who are watching this, you have an opportunity, you have a chance to change the world, to save the world in your next election. Because if you vote for if Hillary Clinton is elected as a world leader, it's going worse. And so every time you think it can't get worse or the future can't get any more depressing, it does. But then you see You see currently, I see people shining through and people coming through and politicians, whether it be Marie Le Pen, whether it be Geert Wilders, whether it be Donald Trump. I don't know all of Donald Trump's political views. What I know is that he's moved the goalposts for the debate, which needed to be done, because for too long people are too scared to say this. So it's so refreshing when you see someone just stand up and speak honestly without worrying about the people who are financing him and backing him and worrying about their money and their profit. So I think that I always used to say 10, 20, 30 years' time, this is all going to come to a head. This has come to a head a lot sooner than that. It's coming to a head a lot sooner than that. And actually, if you look at Al-Qaeda's plan, this is one thing that when I read their plan written 12 years ago, when one of their leaders was speaking about their plans for what they're going to do, it spoke about how weak the West would be after intervening in the Middle East with Iraq and Afghanistan. They were predicting everything, how weak we'd be. So when they do launch their caliphate in Islamic State, we will not send our military in. Yeah? Then if you, each it gives a four-year plan every 4 years of what they'll be doing. 2016, it says, total confrontation with the non-believers. Now, what happened on New Year's Eve? New Year's Eve of 2016. What happened on the New Year's Eve? The first day of 2016, they attacked 1,000 women in Cologne alone. They attacked women across the whole of Europe. It's in, it actually, word for word, what he said, are in Europe, our invading Islamic army will start full confrontation with the kafir. That was the first thing they go for. The weakest people they go for are women, which is exactly what they did on New Year's Eve. And then they say there will be a five-year battle where they will have complete war and confrontation with us. Anyone who looks at last week in Europe, we're at war. We're at war. This ain't going away. When people understand that the jihad, they haven't even launched their jihad yet. Not a proper jihad. When it's properly launched, we're dealing with 4%. We're dealing with a pathetic, small, poor 4%. And look at the chaos that they're bringing. So you think when Europe hits 20%, the Europe already that you think you know or America thinks you know has changed beyond belief. It's changed beyond belief. Everything's changing and turning in the way of Islam. And that, and fully supporting it are our politicians and our political elite. And as the Islamic demographic grows, their vote bank politics will become stronger and stronger and stronger. And then, I know it's depressing, but we have a very difficult future.
No, I mean, you talked about why more people don't speak up. I mean, I made a video saying Islam's not religion of peace. It wasn't even that inflammatory. 7 months ago, I'm still getting death threats every week for a YouTube video. I mean, that's why people don't speak out, because if you criticize Islam and say it's not religion of peace, they send you messages, they give you threatening calls, they leave, you know, notes saying, I'm going to prove Islam's a religion of peace by violently killing you. This is why reformists within Islam, you know, ex-Muslims, don't want to speak out against it, because it's not fun getting death threats all the time. You had Ayaan Hirsi Ali's colleague, you know, killed on the streets of Amsterdam, I think it was, simply for working with her on projects that try to reform Islam from within. It's an environment, you know, that encourages intimidation and violent threats to anyone who questions this religion. Then you've got pressure from above. My cousin, who is gay, retweeted me when I criticized Saudi Arabia for executing gay people. He was hauled in, works for a major university, was hauled into a meeting and said, you can't even retweet that information because it might offend the Saudi Arabian students who are coming to our college. And, you know, concurrent to this, they'll have gay pride marches and they'll fly a rainbow flag over the university. But God forbid you would actually try to criticize governments that execute homosexuals. That might offend somebody. That's bad. And so people are scared to talk out because they might get death threats. They might lose their lives, or at the very least, they might lose their jobs and their careers because of this public shaming culture. That's why the left is just as much to blame for this. Correct, Tommy?
I've experienced everything you've just spoke about. In my 5-6 years of leading the English Defence League, I had school teachers on the phone in tears to me because what the left, and these are organisations that are funded by people supporting open borders, many of whom have funded them from America, such as Searchlight, Hope Not Hate. What they do is, say you've got a member of one of my organisations, and he's making comments about Islam, Free speech, not inciting hate, just telling the truth about Islam. And he works for BMW, for example. Then they would screenshot everything. Then they would contact the HR department of BMW. These people are being paid to do this. They're being paid to do this, and it works. It's a scary, it's a tactic that works as well. Because before you know it, that's why when people use fake names, I get a lot of hassle. You use a pseudonym and people don't, and at our demonstrations, people cover their faces. You're going to lose your job. You're going to lose your career. What you have to understand as well is many people, for example, people that I know, their bosses will be Muslim. This isn't everywhere. They're infiltrated everywhere at different levels. And this is a far left tactic, which is quite a successful tactic that they use to intimidate people into silence. But it's also quite encouraging when you have people. I feel Milo this week, I think is brilliant. When I see someone who doesn't care, that's the attitude. When I see someone who just doesn't care, yeah, what anyone's going to say or do, I think it's brilliant. Yourself, I know it's not like you don't get scared, because if you walked through Luton, buddy, you'd get attacked. You'd get violently attacked. So it's not like it's not scary or intimidating, but it has to be done. And I always think that the more people that do it, the more inspiration it gives to others to do it. And all we're doing is telling the truth. But in the times that we're currently facing, telling the truth is a revolutionary act. That's it. That's where we're at. And everyone is scared. And I always said, when I walk through Luton and there's plenty of videos, I've been punched, I've been beaten, I've been attacked. That's why my local politician didn't say what I say. Because he probably quite enjoys walking through Luton and going across to coffee. Yeah? And that's the same with everyone. Most politicians, and I know from my experience, and what, you know, I've been on to every debate show, every talk show in the UK, whether it be Newsnight, all of them. Yeah. And everywhere I go, I don't get a bad reception. And in fact, everyone shakes my hand and tells me to keep going. So I even know the people interviewing me, who when the camera's on, they're grilling me and giving me a hard time. But as soon as the camera's off, they're shaking my hand and saying they admire what I do. And that, because they're scared, because everyone's scared. And you know, you said like, there's more of a hoo-ha about, there is a very loud, prominent voice given to the far left, these apologists, these liberals, but they're not the majority at all. The majority of people in the UK have had enough of Islam and the effect it's going to have on our nation and our children's future. The majority of people. That's the reality. So we've been punching well below our weight for a long time, but we need to understand that we're on the majority side, not some minority. We've seen that even with the Brexit case and people trying to vote for Brexit and the way they tried to turn that into a race issue, which it never was. It was a vote for culture. A vote for culture and identity before it was a vote for the economy, but which they kept crying on about. But yeah, I don't know. We are in big problems.
Well, I mean, the majority of Sikhs voted for Brexit. Are they racist right-wingers? I think the point to make is, it's an unfortunate term, but if we've got a target-rich environment where everybody is speaking out against Islam, there won't be so much pressure on people like you. It won't be as easy to demonize people like you, because again, there'll be a lot more people speaking out. The balance, the load will be more balanced amongst those people, and they won't be able to isolate and attack us, both in terms of character assassination and actual assassination, actual death threats. Let's just finish up with this, though. I'm predicting next, and this is what Al-Qaeda have called for, their leader, they're going to start abducting and killing celebrities. That's their next big step up that they're going to do. You put out a tweet talking about Muslims getting control of commercial airliners. Tell us about that, because we know they've got the jihadists actually working in secure areas of major airports throughout Europe, right?
What was it? In the hundreds before the Euro 2016. It was in the hundreds of Muslims who were on terror watch lists had got jobs in the Euro 2016 football tournament scene. We've seen, I believe it may be up to 30 or 40 police officers have been booted out in Paris alone due to their links to radical extremist organisations. It's only a matter of time because God forbid, you can't just sack them, which they don't. Yeah. For example, when we had the most extremist organisation, Al-Mujahideen, when we had them protest against our armed forces in the UK, one of the main people was a baggage handler at Luton Airport. He was a baggage handler at Luton Airport. So how far away are we? That's why I said, how far away are we from a Muslim who, there are plenty of Muslim pilots now, ordinary Muslim pilots. How far away are we from one of them being switched on, because that's all this is. They're switched on to their jihad, switched on to Islam, and taking down a passenger plane. And all these things, that's why we have to start putting in, which whether people say they're unfair laws or not, things have to, we have to put things in play that protect our citizens. And yeah, when you're on about celebrities as well, I think the next thing that's going to happen, and God forbid, you said, how long is it till people react? I believe in the Northern Ireland style conflict, there were two IRA bombings a day, two attacks a day when a paramilitary British terrorist organisation was set up. We don't want that. No one wants that. But our leaders, our political leaders, our politicians, they must start dealing with this problem. Because when you, as you said, when you have a political platform or a process where you can demonstrate, that's what democracy is. When you're angry, you demonstrate. They try and take that away from you. Like, I face court. Think about this. In France, in Nice. Look at what happened in Nice. Look what happened today. I'm in court on September 19th in the UK for having a fuck ISIS flag. In France. Not in the UK. So I was in France at a football game, and I had my picture taken with a flag, and the British authorities come around my house, come in my house with my wife and children there, take me to court, and now I face charges where they're trying to give me a ban.
Okay. We are back. Final segment of the Alex Jones Show. Remember, tomorrow is Operation Sleeping Giant, the marathon, historic 28-hour broadcast. Again, begins tomorrow. All the information is at infowars.com/giant. You can also support us by getting the products at infowarsstore.com. Now, Tommy reminded me of a story which happened, I think it was last summer here in London. There was a guy openly walking around Westminster and the Houses of Parliament draped in an ISIS flag. The police didn't even take him in for questioning. They let him go. Meanwhile, Tommy is over there at the Euro 2016 football tournament, has an F ISIS flag, basically making fun of a terrorist organization, and now he's being charged. Tommy, tell us about that, and then in the final few minutes, just tell people how they can support you, how they can get your book and follow you on Twitter. Go ahead.
Cool. So, yeah, let's look at the reasons why the police and the authorities do this. In fact, I've got the police from Luton, the Beds police, have openly said, and I've got a recording of them saying it, that they've been forced to do this to me by the Home Office. So I'm in France. I have a Royal Marine, a black British Royal Marine, who has a flag. And he says, can I have his photo? I have my photo taken with him. I hold the flag out, and it has F ISIS on the front of it. That's what, when I returned home from the football, from the Euros, my children come running upstairs crying their eyes out, Daddy, Daddy, police are here, police are here. I go down, there's three police officers. So what are you doing in my house? They're there over this. And that's the comparison. People were walking around with ISIS flags in the UK, nothing. But the reason for this is all part of the same campaign you talk about, of intimidation. I said to them, you're here to intimidate me, to intimidate my family, to harass us into silence. And they've been trying it for 6 years. I don't know why they don't just give up. No matter what they do or say or try to do, I'm not going to be silent ever in anything they try. They should just get that message and give up on it, but they don't. But it does force me, whether they succeed, yes, my children were crying, yes, my wife was upset, yes, it disrupts my home life, yes, the next day, rather than go and see my mum in hospital, I have to go to the court. Now I have another court case pending again and again. It costs money, finance, and it takes up your time and your energy. And I know when I walk into that court, I'm never going to get convicted of anything. What have I done? I've done nothing, but they don't, by that time, they've already got a sentence out of you anyway, because for the last 6 years, I've had court case after court case after court case for stupid little things like this. But it all sort of weighs on your shoulders and causes your problems, and it's a strain on your life. And that's what
they
want to
do. And it's a chilling effect, isn't it? It prevents other people from saying the same kind of thing.
It does, yeah. It has the effect. People look at what they're doing. I had it in the early days of the EDL when they started kicking off my doors. I had my other friends stepping back. Well, I don't want my door kicked in. Even though they're kicking your door in for no reason and they're not charging you, but it has the effect. People see it. People feel fearful. It's like a police state. And, so I'm in court for that on September 19th. I'm actually quite looking forward to it now, if I'm honest, now, because I can't wait to see their argument. And now that the media have got involved, now that everyone's watching what's going on, I can't wait to see them try and argue that I shouldn't have a flag that says F ISIS in France.
It's amazing. Tommy, we just got about 30 seconds left. Tell people how they can get your book, how they can find you on Twitter.
You can buy my book currently on Amazon. It's Tommy Robinson, Enemy of the State. It's on Kindle. You can download it in America. You can download it wherever you are. It's a story of my life. It tells the story of the state and the persecution that I face for trying to tell the truth and identify and warn people of what we're now facing on a daily routine. I try to warn prior to that. And you can follow me on Twitter, Tommy Robinson, New Era.
Okay, there goes Tommy Robinson. Thanks for joining us. Get the book. Again, it's Enemy of the State. Support Tommy. He's been harassed so much by police simply for speaking out against the religion of peace. That's going to wrap it up for today's edition of The Alex Jones Show. Remember, tomorrow is Operation Sleeping Giant, our historic 28-hour broadcast. All the information at Infowars.com/giant. That's going to wrap up the show. Thanks for joining us again. Breaking news, Infowars.com.
And welcome back to The Alex Jones Show. I'm your host, Jakari Jackson. This is the Overdrive segment, the fourth hour. Now, I have a lot of hot news for you here today. There's many things that we want to discuss. We want to talk about what's going on at the DNC. We want to talk about terror attacks. We want to talk about media and propaganda. But first, we want to talk about the exact opposite of that. We're going to talk about Operation Sleeping Giant. That's going to be our 28-hour broadcast that starts tomorrow, 11 a.m. Central, with the Alex Jones Show. Now, to tell you about this, this is a fundraiser. This is a huge sale. You can get a lot of great products for a great discount. You can get Brain Force for 40% off, Survival Shield X2 for 20% off, also Supermale Vitality 20% off, and that's just the beginning. So when you tune in, you can see Alex, of course. You're going to see myself, Leanne McAdoo, David Knight, Joe Biggs, Darren McBreen, everybody here in the crew, as well as many special guests. I know Leanne has a special guest. I'm not sure if I'm supposed to talk about it yet, but I'll say it's a rather smashing interview that should be rather impactful if you happen to be walking through a pumpkin patch, and I'll leave that at that. Also, audio guy, can you take my voice out of my head, please? Thank you so much. All right. So with that said, I personally will be on the air from 4 p.m. to 5 p.m., and this is going to be tomorrow. Also, I'll be back at 2:30 a.m. with Margaret Howell and 10 a.m. to 11 a.m. with Gerald Celente, or more accurately, he'll be hosting the show, and I'll be riding shotgun with him. So you can tune in and see all that coming up tomorrow. You definitely do not want to miss it. It's a great opportunity not only to see the show, but also to support the broadcast, and it's your contributions, it's your support that make everything possible. Because this room I'm sitting in right now, when I first started here 4 years ago, this was just a basic room. It looked like a regular office building. This is where the reporters were stationed, the producers were stationed, and now it's this big, massive studio. And it's your contributions, your support that make this broadcast possible. So thank you, and definitely keep that in mind when it comes to tomorrow. Now, let's get into some other news. And we're going to talk about, you guys remember the Center for Medical Progress? They're the group that were putting out the Planned Parenthood videos. They were going in, filming these people, getting them to say that, or allowing them to say more accurately, that they plan to use the proceeds from these abortions to buy Lamborghinis, all types of atrocious things that were going on with that. Now we see that the last charge has been dismissed against the duo who made the anti-Planned Parenthood videos. And this is a report from CBS. It says a district judge dismissed the tampering with government records charge upon request of the Harris County Prosecutor's Office. And now, the thing about this is it's a kill the messenger kind of society, whether you're talking about Snowden or Assange or Bradley Manning. And of course, in some cases, they put out maybe more information than they should have as far as government secrets with Bradley Manning and things to that nature. But it's still, let's go after the person who put out the information, not the people who are actually doing the deeds. It's the same thing that we see with the Center for Medical Progress, because we see that initially Texas authorities, they were doing an investigation of Planned Parenthood with the fetal tissue and all the things that they had going on, and then they dropped that to go after these guys. But fortunately, their last charge has been dropped, because they were charging them, what was it, with tampering with documents, fraudulent documents. Basically, they were saying that they entered the facilities with a fake ID or something to that sort, and they wanted to charge them for misleading people by using a fake ID. I'm like, okay, so let's say, for the sake of argument, they did do that. They're in a facility exposing how people are using proceeds from fetal tissue to go buy Lamborghinis, and you don't see anything wrong with that. But thus is society. But granted, they did drop it, dismiss it. So good job to those guys over there at the Center for Medical Progress. And from what I understand, they actually had more videos. So they had more stuff that they wanted to release that just wasn't released for whatever reason. Now, stay tuned after this break. We'll have more special reports. We'll have some clips from the guys at the DNC. I have some stuff about terror attacks, about media propaganda, how they're running the spin cycle in overdrive to just to confuse you, to manipulate you, to get you to believe their narrative. Meanwhile, there are real true stories that are going on that aren't getting exposed because of all this bull. So stay tuned right after this for more special reports. And welcome back to the fourth hour. This is the Alex Jones Show, and I am your host, Jakari Jackson. Now let's talk about the terror attacks that are going on worldwide. It seems that there's just no end in sight. You know, you get one, then you get another one, then you get another one, then you get another one. And everybody wants to talk about the violence here in the United States. And yes, we do have a violence problem, whether it's the citizens or the police. Police are citizens too, I understand that, but I'm trying to make that distinction here. But you also have legitimate terror attacks that are going on the other side of the planet that people really don't want to give much credence to. And as Paul Joseph Watson was discussing earlier with his guest, as bad as these things are, you know, the priest who got beheaded recently, next week people are just going to forget all about it. It's going to be like it never even happened, and that's the very sad thing about these type of attacks. And let's start here with this article. French terrorist suspect beheading the priest, or suspected of beheading the priest, excuse me, was allowed to roam unsupervised. And it turns out one of the attackers who killed and beheaded a 86-year-old Catholic priest was a convicted terrorist. Now, the thing I want to point out in this article, great article by Kurt Nimmo, is that this man is a convicted terrorist, not even a suspected terrorist, a convicted terrorist, and they were basically putting him under house arrest with an ankle monitor. It blows my mind that they would do this with a suspected terrorist, because I used to work in a jail, and the people who got ankle monitors were like maybe a purse snatcher or somebody who stole some stuff at Walmart, you know, just really petty offenses that nobody got hurt in. This guy is a known terrorist, but they are going to put him basically on the honor system and say, please stay home with your parents. Don't go out and kill anybody so we can keep you under surveillance. The man's a known terrorist, and you expect him not to cut off that ankle monitor. But this is the type of world we live in. And Nimmo points out, the attack occurred despite extraordinary surveillance and police state measures imposed on the country following the attacks in Paris in November and an earlier attack on Charlie Hebdo. So as we see, these attacks continue to happen against a largely disarmed populace. And every time it happens, they're just like, oh, we didn't know how this happened. We're so surprised. We're so shocked. I'm like, well, they keep happening and they keep happening and they keep happening. At what point are you going to realize that you have a problem with the terrorist in your country? But this is a more straightforward article than I've seen in other places, because at least they're admitting that these terror attacks are happening. I covered this article last week and I have it pulled up here. This is a CNN whitewash. And this is why, a case in point example, why I don't go off press releases, because we go to these events and you get one from a senator or from a congressman or the police, and they say, we want you to regurgitate this to your viewers and tell them our version of what happened. And as I can tell you from being on the scene in many of these examples, situations, scenarios around the country, what the police report says, what the press release says, isn't always exactly that accurate. And this is one of those reasons. Rebels in Syria call boys' beheading a mistake. So basically, the Western-backed Syrian rebels, which we've been funding, aiding, arming, making excuses for, we continue to make excuses for, because a group of rebels, Syrian rebels, quote unquote, many of them have sworn their allegiance to Al-Qaeda and other terrorist organizations, but let's not go too deep into that. They went into a village and they rounded up a group of men that they said were anti-fighters, were fighting against them. One of the people that they rounded up was a little boy, which in CNN's own report could have been as young as 10 years old. They then proceeded to saw the boy's head off with a knife. And the gentleman you see on your screen right there is a representative from the State Department. And he's like, well, we'll look into it, and we're allowing the Syrian rebels to investigate themselves. And at one point, a reporter jumps up. He says, Mr. State Department man, if it comes out that it is true and accurate that your Western-backed Syrian rebels did cut this boy's head off, will you stop your funding to the Syrian rebels? And that gentleman right there, he said, quote, it would give us pause. It would give us pause if we found out the Syrian rebels that saws somebody's head off, a little boy's head off on video, it'll give us pause to continue to fund them. Not we're going to stop funding them, not we're going to go attack them, not anything else. It will give us pause to think about it in such a way. And the rebels who did the killing of the young man, the little boy, they said it was an individual mistake. That is a quote, is a individual mistake that they held a boy down and cut his head off. And then they had the heads at CNN just regurgitate the talking, the press release. And I'd like to think that the person who wrote this article didn't like it. They were just trying to, you know, play it straight down the middle. But there's times you can't, you just can't do that because the news is so egregious. And I would not want to vouch for the people who made this quote mistake or the State Department who came out with just a very milquetoast, lackluster response to this very sinister crime. And this isn't anything new because as we've pointed out, whether it's the Syrian rebels or other groups of the people who just killed the priest the other day, these attacks continue to happen. They've been happening for a very long time, but they're just now starting to get the media attention that they deserve. We've given you several articles, Paul Joseph Watson leading the charge on that, about these groups that are going into villages, they're killing the priests, they're burning down the churches, they're knocking down the monuments, and so on and so on and so on. And this has been going on for a number of years, but as I said, it's just now starting to get some traction in the media. And as we talk about the media propaganda machine, one of the things that's really hot and heavy right now is trying to blame Russia for the hacks at the DNC. And Assange has come out and countered this, and he says it's nothing but media propaganda. And this article from the site, the establishment media has virtually ignored the revelations contained in the WikiLeaks DNC email hack and has instead pushed the accusation Russia is attempting to influence the U.S. election. On Monday, WikiLeaks founder Julian Assange told NBC News there's no proof whatsoever his outfit received the 20,000-plus DNC emails from the Russians. The real story is what these emails contain, and they show collusion at the top of the Democratic Party to derail Sanders' campaign, he said. In a very similar way, it reminded me of the Sony hack. You guys recall that hack that was supposedly done by North Korea because of the movie The Interview. You know, it was just so offensive that they had to hack into Sony's server and stop this movie from coming out. But if you recall, I have this throwback article, FBI busted falsely blaming North Korea for Sony hack. And this is what I was talking about with the media manipulation, whether it's with the Russians or somebody else. There's always some boogeyman out there. And this article says, here's a sample of top cybersecurity experts who say that North Korea was not behind the Sony hack. And we have Peter Singer. He's one of the nation's foremost experts in cybersecurity, renowned hacker and DEF CON organizer, Mark Rogers, John Dixon, former Air Force intelligence officer, cyber risk consulting company, risk-based security, Kim Zetter, who works for Wired, and on and on and on the list goes. But once again, they tell you that it was North Korea. They tell you that it's the Russians because those are the boogeymen at the time. By no means making excuses for those people. All those groups have various issues and things that need to be dealt with. But I'm one of those people, you blame the person who actually did the crime. You don't say, I don't like this person, so I'm going to pin something else on them, because it'd be a situation, say, a bank robbery, for example, right? So you don't know who did the bank robbery, but you know, Joe down the street, he's a bad character, you know, bad actor, been up to some stuff all these years, and then you go blame it on him. Well, even if you are happy you got Joe off the street, you still got the guys who actually robbed the bank running around free and easy, and they're not looking over their shoulder because they know that nobody is looking for them. And those are the type of things that you have to deal with when you go through the media cycle. It's all types of things, all types of propaganda, things you have to deal with, the lies, the disinformation, just as we were talking about with the Syrian rebels beheading the boy. It's a complete spin cycle. And then somebody was showing me this article earlier today. I forgot to print it out. But there was the attack of the Syrian man with the suicide bomb. He went to some music festival, can't recall exactly where it was, blew himself up, injured 15 or so people, and then the whitewashed article was a Syrian rebel or a Syrian refugee was killed in a bomb blast. I'm like, that is technically accurate, but you left out the part where he assembled the bomb and then blew himself up. Oh, there it is. You guys got it right there. So yeah, they try to spin it and make it seem like he was the victim. He's a victim of his own stupidity, I guess you could say, but he blew himself up on purpose. So I don't see how you could spin that. But this is just the political correctness, the world we live in, where they say Syrian migrant dies in German blast. I'm like, bro, you kind of killed yourself in that situation. And these are the things that they want you to believe, the whitewashes that go on out there. This is why you have to have a very well-rounded view of the news. And get your news from multiple sources, because not everybody's going to be right all the time. So I do encourage people to go to various sources, look around at different articles on different sites, see what what New York Times says versus Washington Post versus whoever, and try to see, are there consistencies, or in some cases they just do the straight talking point thing. Like, they'll get something from Reuters or, you know, AP or whatever else, and they'll just rebrand it, just put their own headline on it. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about if different people are writing it, try to see if there are other angles and aspects to it. A case in point, when you talk about the 1993 World Trade attack, 1993, they wanted to blame it on the guy, but he said, no, I have the tapes. I have the tapes of me talking to the FBI. Many people didn't know that until the guy came out with the tapes, and I believe it was on CBS and New York Times or something like that. And this is why you have to have a very wide view of the news, because I meet people and say, well, how do you know what to believe? Really, you just do your research. You try to find who you consider to be reputable, and reputable isn't just because they work for Agency X. I mean, I'm sure there are some good things that come out of CNN, but the one I just told you about isn't one of them. So you try to find people that you find reputable, and then from that aspect, you try to look at the stories, find consistencies, inconsistencies, and see the State Department's driving it, if somebody who has some skin in the game, so to speak, is the one putting out the article or trying to influence the narrative. And that's just a little brief piece of that. Now, when we come back after this break, we'll be talking about the DNC. We'll have some special reports, some videos that's going on up there, because they have all these celebrities coming out to support Mrs. Clinton. And then on the opposite side, they have people who aren't supporting Mrs. Clinton. Those people aren't really making the headlines, like the people who are just towing the party line. And even the Bernie bros are feeling the burn, because now the guy who told them that he was anti-establishment, he wasn't with the big banks, is saying you need to support the person who is with the big banks. We'll have that coming up right after this break. And welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. This is the fourth hour, and I'm your host, Jakari Jackson. Now, coming up after this segment, we're going to be taking your calls. So I'm going to give that number out now so you can go ahead and get your call in. It is 1-800-259-9231. Once again, the number to call in is 800-259-9231, and we will be taking your calls right after this segment. Now, before we get to all that, I want to remind you about Operation Sleeping Giant. It is the Supercell fundraiser. It kicks off tomorrow at 11 a.m. It is a 28-hour broadcast, live broadcast. You can catch, of course, Alex, myself, Rob Dew, Leanne, Darren McBreen, the guys out there in the field, David Knight, Joe Biggs, and so many more who are going to be joining us on that broadcast. In addition to all the great content that you're going to get live, you can also get great specials on the products, including but not limited to 40% off of Brain Force, 20% off of Survival Shield X2, and also 20% off of Super Male Vitality. And that's just the beginning. You definitely don't want to miss all the great things we have coming up for you in that broadcast tomorrow. Now, let's talk about the DNC. In the DNC, it's a little bit different from the RNC, because you go out to the RNC, you see, you know, people fighting, you know, shoving in the crowds, all this kind of stuff. A lot of different types of people. I don't know the best way to say it when you go to the DNC, because when you go to the DNC, you meet all these anti-Hillary people. You go to the RNC, you had a lot of pro-Trump people, but DNC, you have the anti-Hillary people. You have the Bernie bros, so to speak. And many of the Bernie bros are feeling the burn, because they're saying, hey, I want to back Bernie Sanders because he was this guy who's going to come in and be different from everybody else. He wasn't going to take money from the big banks. He was going to fight for the little guy. And now they're seeing him shift to pushing this big establishment candidate who does take money from the big banks. And you have the Bernie Sanders people. I keep seeing these articles. They're wearing the Hillary for prison t-shirts, or they have the chant, lock Hillary up. And we have the Sanders campaign manager saying, stop chanting, lock her up. And he says, I know emotions are running high now, but I think people really have to consider the implications of what a Trump presidency would mean to those who support the kind of agenda that Bernie Sanders has laid out for the country. It's so funny to me. They're so adamant about booing Mrs. Clinton. These people are so upset that they are going out there and they're chanting, they're telling people to get off the stage, they're booing people off the stage, and we have some of these people right here. Because when you go to the DNC, they have this very long list of celebrities. I'm sure more coming up. They had a big list. It was Lena Dunham and Snoop Dogg and Eva Longoria, Sarah Silverman, who we have this article right here. Sarah Silverman gets booed at the DNC for telling Bernie Sanders supporters that they're ridiculous. And we have that video coming up. You guys can get that ready to run. So basically, you have this famous comedian, you know, movies, TV shows, all that kind of stuff. And in the spirit of the DNC of booing the people who support Mrs. Clinton, the Bernie Sanders supporters booed Sarah Silverman. And she wasn't very happy about this, but she's just one of the many people who have been booed at this event. We have also clips of Elizabeth Warren, of course, Bernie Sanders himself, and we'll get those all ready for you in just 1 second. So you go to the DNC, and in addition to the people who are supporting Bernie Sanders, you have many people who are not. Susan Sarandon, who's been a longtime activist on various things, I don't agree with them all at all, but she's taking to the DNC to say that, hey, I'm not supporting this woman just for the fact that she is a woman. Also, you have people like Rosario Dawson. She's been in Sin City and Daredevil, many other movies and TV shows as well. And she's saying, no, I'm a, I guess for lack of a better term, a Bernie bro. She wanted to show her support for Bernie Sanders. She's a diehard Sanders supporter. And now she's feeling that burn because she has to go to the DNC and be told by people like Sarah Silverman that she's supposed to support the Democratic candidate no matter what. And though I don't agree with all the Sanders supporters, I don't agree with many of Sanders' policies, the things that he said, the self-proclaimed Democratic socialist, but I do respect the fact that these people are not blindly pushing the Democratic Party line. They're not going to say that I'm going to vote for anybody on a straight ticket just because they're in my party or supposed party. I'm going to vote for the person who I think is best for the nation, and that's what you see when you look at celebrities like Rosario Dawson and other people as well. May not agree with the politics, but I do respect the fact that they're standing up for what they truly believe in. Do you guys have those clips ready?
We have got to elect Hillary Clinton and Tim Kaine.
He's like stressing the crowd like a college professor. He's not liking it. There's people in the background telling everybody to be quiet. There's people in the crowd putting their thumbs down. They don't want anything to do with this.
Brothers and sisters.
Brothers and sisters, I've sold you out to the establishment. You need to vote for Mrs. Clinton.
We're on the march.
And the Empire is on the run. We'll be back right after this.
So let's talk politics because okay. I know you care deeply and you've been a Bernie supporter.
Yes, I am a Bernie supporter.
Bernie.
So I tell you this, I will vote for Hillary with gusto.
Hillary takes money from banks and big business and super PACs. So did Barack Obama. She's no different than anybody else. She was the best choice, I thought, considering they all do it. Then someone came along who doesn't take steroids.
Can I just say to the Bernie or bust people, you're being ridiculous.
He's not for sale, not playing the game, and says what he means. And
I am proud to be a part of Bernie's movement, and a vital part of that movement is making absolutely sure that Hillary Clinton is our next president of the United States. Booyah, Baba Booey.
What? Listen to that. Listen to that. Listen to what you did. This is a comedian. This is the power of comedy.
Thank God they can fix this in post.
And that was Sarah Silverman, the comedian. And then as you say, like, I'm glad they could fix this in post. Nah, I think it's already out there, Sarah. And that's the mentality that we've seen. These hardcore Bernie people, like I said, I got much respect for people who continue to support him, even though I don't support him. But the people who are switching gears and they're saying that now you have to support Mrs. Clinton because Bernie does, you can see people are booing Bernie himself, much less a celebrity or supporter like Sarah Silverman. Now, before we go on to our calls, I know we have people holding, but we have this new report that Alex just shot, and this is emergency. Hillary plans to steal election from Trump. This is a brand new video, hot video from Alex Jones, and let's play a little bit of that.
Ladies and gentlemen, it is Tuesday, the 26th day of July, 2016. In less than 24 hours, we're going to be live for 28 hours with a very special broadcast kicking off at 11 a.m. tomorrow, carried by radio stations, TV stations, and cable stations across the United States. Almost 200 radio stations alone. But anyone can watch at Infowars.com/show. Also, Infowars.com/giant. It is Operation Sleeping Giant. The Sleeping Giant is already partially awakened. The information we cover about the globalist takeover of America is now being mainstreamed by Donald Trump here in the U.S., Nigel Farage, and the British exit movement in Europe, and more. InfoWars is the tip of the spear. A lot of people claim to be the tip of the spear. We are the leading edge. You are the tip of the spear. You are the resistance, our 28 million viewers and listeners a week. I'm here on Facebook mentions, YouTube, and Periscope to break down the fact that I have talked to high levels of the Trump campaign, not just Roger Stone, and they are fully aware of the fact that Hillary has stolen the election from Bernie Sanders. He was like 25 points ahead of her. He won California, New Hampshire, and eight other states by massive points. They've now stolen that. They've now created superdelegates to ignore the voters and the delegates. Trump is surging 5 to 10 points, depending on the scientific poll, ahead of Hillary as the emails come out and the corruption and the fact that she sent protesters to Trump events to cause violence dressed up as Sanders supporters. Trump is surging. Even mainline analysts admit the Democratic Party is in full panic right now. Full panic. They're going to strike back with a staged event, an attempted assassination attempt, I think is possible. Get in the mind of Hillary and her foreign bank, Goldman Sachs handlers. What would you do? Stage an assassination attempt, a terrorist attack, blame it on Trump supporters. What would they pull? Because she's imploding. They're booing Bernie Sanders and Elizabeth Warren and all of them. Debbie Wasserman Schultz, when they get up there and push all this garbage, when they say your vote doesn't count. What are they going to do when upwards of 70, 80% of the people we've talked to were Sanders voters around the country? They weren't for Hillary. We've done exit polls and 80% in California going for Sanders in LA, live on TV. What are they going to do when most of those Sanders voters don't?
That's a special broadcast from Alex. You can catch the rest of that report on Infowars.com talking about Operation Sleeping Giant, which of course kicks off tomorrow. Now let's go to our calls. Let's see who's been holding the longest. I believe it is Cole in Georgia. Cole, you want to talk about Mrs. Clinton? Go ahead.
Hey, Jakari, what's going on?
How you doing?
I just wanted to see, get y'all's take on what you think about Hillary. What kind of false flag do you think she might pull? Do you think it might be like a school shooting or building?
Well, I'm not so much saying a false flag or anything. I'm more concerned about her agenda if she gets into office. She's been very blatant about her views on firearms, on personal liberties, things of that nature. She's been covering up for her husband, I guess that's the best nice way I could put it, the man who has been accused of multiple sexual assaults, not consensual stuff with Monica. That's a whole nother game. I'm talking about people who said that he held them down and took something from them. That concerns me very deeply. So I'm more concerned about those type of things.
There's one thing I was talking about too. I heard a little birdie tell me one time about how they got private contractors, you know, Blackwater, and I guess I mentioned that name, Blackwater, that work in the CIA. They got it in the FBI and the Secret Service, all into there.
Yeah, I mean, Blackwater's been caught in some, you know, very murky waters. I believe they changed their name at some point because the situation where they shot some civilians overseas. So. Yeah, definitely some tough customers, and only time to tell. Thank you so much, Cole. Let's go now to Michael in Texas. Go ahead, Michael.
Hey, Jakari, a pleasure. I want to talk about how it seems to me, with all due respect to the entire InfoWars team,
that Paul Joseph Watson seems to be the only one that truly gets it. This is not radical Islam. This is fundamental Orthodox Islam. It has been a 1,400-year scourge on this planet. It never had a renaissance. Like Christianity is the renaissance to Judaism. This is fundamental. And you guys, your own material supports my claim. You guys put out a very powerful video after the Orlando shooting showing a Florida imam asking his jam-packed Sunni congregation if they were extremist and radical. They all said no. And he said that the best punishment that we could give humankind is to kill homosexuals and adulteresses and the like. As a matter of fact, your video was so great that I cut it into an MP3 audio for my morning show, Mike's Hot Seat, and I play it, you know, several times because it's so powerful. This is fundamental Islam. We've got to stop the political correctness and call it what it is.
Well, when you talk about, I know the video you're referencing, and I definitely understand the point you're making with that. The thing that I think everybody has to realize is when you talk about fundamental Islam, not everybody is participating in these activities. Now, I'm very much aware, like when you say that the video where he's saying, we're not extremists if you believe X, or it's not extremists if you do that. The majority of Muslims don't go out and commit these actions that we see these terrorists doing, whether it's the train attacks or the mass shootings or the axe attacks. Most Muslims, they go home, they do a seemingly normal life. There are those who don't believe it's an extremist ideology, but they do participate in those actions. Yes, I do definitely recognize that.
I want to counter that real quick.
Sure.
First of all, yeah, it's true that not everyone carries it out. But I want to equate that to our support as Americans for the United States military, but it's the military-industrial complex that shoots off American imperialism. Alex Jones had interviewed someone a couple of weeks ago who brought up Pew Research. And it shows that 26% of Muslims in America approve of suicide bombings, 42% in France. And those are the only ones that were brave enough to answer the survey honestly. Mm-hmm. So that has nothing to do with it. Only a few are carrying out. It is the thought. Then you have the action. So it's support, then it's action, cause and effect. So I disagree with you that it's only a few people. You have a few executioners, but you have many supporters. And that's the bottom line behind this ideology. It's an evil ideology and should be declassified as a religion and banned in the United States of America. Or, sir, mark my words, we will be France and Germany. And you heard it here from me, Mike's Hot Seat.
Well, Mike, much of what you just said, I understand the point that you're making. That when you made the allusion to the American military, I understand there are many things that I don't agree with them doing. But once again, not everybody's in the military. So I'm not so much, I won't say I disagree with everything you say. I probably agree with most of what you said there. But I guess it's just a tomato-tomato. You have your views and I have mine. Is there anything else that you'd like to say?
Yes, I would. Just real quick about Bernie Sanders. I thought he was a riot last night. He said that this election is not about the 1%. Meanwhile, the guy recently endorses the face of the 1%. So I just find that beautiful. And I challenge anyone to watch Hillary's America and then tell me that they can vote Democrat ever again. And that's about it. And I really appreciate your time.
Thank you so much, Michael. All right, let's go on. Well, let me give the number out again before we move on to our next caller. The number to call in is 1-800-259-9231. Once again, it is 1-800-259-9231. Let's go now to Cash in Missouri. Go ahead, Cash.
Hey, Jacari, how you doing?
Doing good. Yourself?
Good. Fine. Thanks. It's been a while since I saw you. I met you on the Missouri campus when at the Thomas Jefferson statue.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
When you were up there in Missouri. Yeah.
Yeah, I remember that.
But I have some ideas to help fund the Hillary for prison meme.
Mm-hmm.
My wife and I are loyal customers of your great products and loyal listeners as well. But every time we receive an order, we get a bumper sticker that you throw in there for free, or two or three sometimes. And I've deployed those very well. They're on our cars, or they're on my truck. I give them away. I wear my Hillary for Prison shirt. And when somebody says, wow, where'd you get that? I go out to the car, get a bumper sticker that has Infowars.com on it. I give them a bumper sticker. But why don't you have Hillary for prison bumper stickers yet?
That is beyond me. That's not my department. I'm sure the guys are listening to this, and they may take that under action. But as far as why we do, we don't have X product, that's not my department.
Get to the marketing department, because you can sell those for a dollar a piece, or, you know, you buy a shirt, get one free. Mm-hmm. But bumper stickers, I mean, I could pass those things out all day long. I mean, I'd be the first one to buy 100 of them.
Oh, great. Okay.
Bumper stickers, hats. You know, I'd love to have one of those, you know, those see-through screens you put on your rear mirror or rear window on your pickup truck.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about.
I'd love to have the artwork and Hillary for prison on the back of my truck.
Okay, well, I'll definitely pass that along to everybody else. Anything else, Cash?
Nope, I just think you could make tens of thousands of dollars if you were selling bumper stickers for a buck a piece.
Very good. All right, thank you so much, Cash. All right, let's go on now to, who's it, Eric? Is that Mississippi? Hello, Eric.
Hey, what's up, Jakari?
Hey, how you doing?
Y'all are doing a great job, dude. Doing pretty good. My question was, you know, at what point does Hillary become a liability to all her backers? I mean, and what would happen if that happened? Because it just seems like, I mean, we're going to watch her tomorrow or whenever she speaks in her, you know, mousy tongue outfit telling us we're all racist. You know, at what point do the people that are backing her and, you know, helping her, or is she just at the very tip top of it?
Well, I think she's just in that house of cards. And if she goes down, a lot of people go down with her. And it's to the point where you talk about the things with the election, how she had all the superdelegates before, you know, Bernie even, you know, put his pants on, to, you know, the crimes of her husband, to the Benghazi thing, to the email thing. I mean, there's really nothing they won't do to prop up this woman. So I think people just view it as backing a winner, because regardless of what she does, you know, it's kind of like, you know, a fixed boxing match or some type of sporting event. You know, if you hamstring all the horses, and, you know, Hillary's horse isn't the best, but, you know, it has at least four healthy legs, you may back that. So I think that's what it is. It's just more people backing somebody who they know is going to get the ultimate backing in the cover-ups to be successful in her campaign.
Oh.
That's just my opinion.
All right, well, yeah, I agree. Well, man, I got a rebuttal to the dude about the Muslim. Mm-hmm. I mean, the Muslim stuff. You know, these people need to understand. We need, like, some Muslim leaders to step up to have a renaissance in Islam. We can't say that it just can't be done and we got to kill them all. That ain't going to work. Trump needs to say, look, we'd love to have you here if you're going to be, love our people, love this freedom we have. Otherwise, we're not putting up with y'all blowing up crap every other week. I mean, it's just not going to happen.
Mm-hmm.
They're not going to do it here.
Yeah, and I mean, I definitely don't want to put words in the guy's mouth. You know, I agreed with some of the points he made. You know, I ultimately, you know, I'm not trying to kick people out of the country or anything like that. I definitely don't want any type of physical confrontation. You know, if it comes to you in a case-to-case basis, then you do what you have to do at that point. But, you know, he's welcome to his views and opinions, and you have yours just as I have mine.
Yeah.
All right.
Well, I think there could be a renaissance with Islam. I mean, I really do. Has anybody asked them to have some people step up, or, you know?
Well, I think the issue is, you know, just like the video that he was referencing that I was aware of, you know, it was a big room, I don't know if you saw it, of, you know, Muslim men, and they're talking about, do you think this is extreme? Do you think that's extreme? And people are like, no, I'm not an extremist. I think that's very orthodox. So I understand the point he was making, but the point I was trying to counter with is, like, not everybody does these things. There are people who, you know, claim to be Christian who don't go to church, or they view church as, you know, their right to get straight to God. It's much more than that. Just like in a situation we talk about Islam or any other faith, you have people who may self-identify with it, but they don't take the rules or principles within the sacred text all the way to heart. And that's the point, I guess, I made a little more eloquently than I did earlier. Sorry, Eric, I got to cut you off. I got to move real quick. Let's go to Steven in Florida.
Yeah, hey, Jakari. I wanted to say this, okay, on the heels of the man that called in talking about Islam and, you know, your last caller and just basically the overall scheme of what InfoWars covers. And I mentioned to the screener I wanted to talk about basically the overall scheme of politics in America, but this gets into a bigger issue. You know, Alex's theme is there's a war on for your mind, and he uses the term InfoWars from basically psychological operations in the military. And we are in a war. I wholeheartedly support InfoWars. I mean, I give out information from them all the time. I buy a lot of your products. But the thing is, this is much bigger than a war for people's minds. This is really a war that's been going on since creation started, since creation started, and that is a war. And Alex says all the time.
All right, just one second, Steven. We have to go to break. I'll come back and let you finish up very fast. We also have some other callers. So just stay right there, and we'll be back right after this break here on The Alex Jones Show. And welcome back to the final segment of The Alex Jones Show. I'm your host, Jakari Jackson. We want to tell you about Operation Sleeping Giant. It is our super sale and fundraiser. And in addition to all the great content that you're going to get, it's a 28-hour broadcast. It's going to include, of course, Alex, myself, Leanne McAdoo, David Knight, Darren McBreen, and so many others here in the studio and around the nation. But you can also get great products at a deep discount. Right now, we have 40% off Brain Force, 20% off Survival Shield X2, and 20% off Supermale Vitality. And, of course, the live broadcast starts tomorrow at 11 a.m. Now, Steven in Florida, I have 5 callers on the board. I'd like to get to all of them. So if you could maybe take 30 seconds and wrap up your final point, then I want to get to Retroactive, Jason, Jim in Her Valley. Go ahead, Steven.
Yeah, what I wanted to say is this. There's a war that's been going on. This is what the war is about. It's a spiritual war between Satan and God. I don't care if anyone says there is no Satan, there's no God. My Bible says there is. And the bottom line is this, Jakari. This war is only going to be won if we recognize that we have made God our enemy. That's the main problem, not the New World Order. It is God who is allowing our enemies to take over because this nation has turned away from the God of our founding fathers, Jesus Christ. And the main problem in America is the fake Christianity that is complicit with the world and complacent about the mission God has given them to reach souls with the message of Jesus Christ and stand up against the evil. And until that turns around, it's going to get worse and worse. And I'm going to make a prediction. America is facing a crash and a total collapse, and it's not going to be stopped by Donald Trump or Alex Jones or anyone else. It's only going to be stopped by Jesus Christ when his people turn back to him. If we don't do that, we are done as a nation.
All right, thank you so much. Yeah, I definitely agree that the country is lost spiritually. I will agree with you on that. Thank you so much, Stephen. Let's go now to Retroactive in Indiana. Go ahead.
Yes, Jakari, can you hear me?
Yes, very quick.
All right. I just wanted to talk about, interject some common sense into the talking points of the DNC trying to say that the Russians, you know, hacked the DNC, saying that their evidence is geography, language, forensic evidence, and motive. Mm-hmm. All right. Who's to say when hackers are hacking? All right. You know, most of them are up at 3 a.m., you know, in our time zone. So that's just ridiculous. The language, they said that they left Cyrillic, a Cyrillic character from an alphabet. Are you serious? I mean, honestly, who's going to leave anything on purpose other than just to kind of offset the blame? And then the evidence that they said that they had was metadata suggesting that the attack came out of Russia. Okay, so who's going to be hacking from their own, you know, their own computer in their own home state, let alone their own country? Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And then you got the motive saying that they've previously tried before. Well, so has China and all these other places that actually go after our infrastructure, right? And she's saying that Hillary's saying that Trump is dangerous while she's like willy-nilly pointing the finger at Russia. She would start a war just to gain power. That's ridiculous. I mean, don't you agree? That's just kind of crazy just to say, oh, they did it. And
oh, yeah, I definitely agree that they need more information. As I was saying earlier with the Sony hack, you know, somebody could have a VPN or any number of other things to make it show up in some other location. Sorry, Retroactive, we got to move quick. Let's go to Her Valley in Texas. Go ahead.
Good afternoon. The question that I want to pose is, let me preface by saying that, you know, before the globalists can further their movement, a collapse, economic or social collapse, which may I add is inevitable, is necessary. The question that I have is, do you believe that we're all being played for fools and that if, you know, Trump was to be elected, that he's going to be used as a scapegoat to blame for the fall.
I mean, I've never supported Trump in general, so I'm probably not the best person to ask that question to. I don't expect either candidate or candidates to solve the problems facing the nation right now. Sorry to our other callers, Jason and Jim, calling tomorrow, and you can get to the front of the line. That's it for this episode of The Alex Jones Show.